Ethiopia.
All right, graphic.
EFF page 39 of the newspaper on the business page. We also have the story there saying deadline for individual bondholders ends today. And basically saying it's important to note that the periodic, they are saying that today, reports written them indicate that response has been extremely poor, with millions of bondholders refusing to sign on, a development confirmed by some of the banks. So yeah, most of the same thing.
Let's be clear, they may not need 100% uptake, but
they need like 50%.
Yes, so, but it look, you know, Selom asked the government rep on the big issue on Saturday how many people had taken up the offer, and he couldn't say. He said he didn't have the right to say. But the other panelists said, well, if it was a good number, you'd have told us. So let's deal with the contractors. Oh. Pay our 5.9 billion CD debt to save our companies, road contractors, to government. Now, this story says, the Association of Road Contractors Ghana has called on government to urgently settle the 5.9 billion CD owed them to prevent their companies from collapsing. Now, last year, Sector Minister Kwesi Amokwata assured Ghanaian road contractors that government would pay them a chunk of the debt before the end of the year while gradually settling the rest. But the National Chairman of the Association, John Afo Jr., said, or told City News, the government only paid an insignificant amount of the total debt. He called on government to speedily pay significant amounts owed the contractors to help save their companies and also to pay their creditors. According to him, their banks are on their necks and they don't know what to do.
And staying with issues having to do with the economy, if you go to the front page of the Ghanaian Times, the story actually on page 11, we're told that the GRA was able to back some 75.5 billion in 2022, beating revenue targets by some 3.6 billion. And the story says that efforts by the Ghana Revenue Authority, GRA, to increase revenue mobilization are yielding the desired results, as data from the authority shows that it collected more revenue in 2022 than it was taxed.
Then pay the contractors, because you know the contractors were citing SNIT and GRA as part of the reason for their woes. So if they have overrun their target by over 3 billion, it should reflect in our fiscal.
You know, sometimes they collect the money, but somehow the finance ministry does not release the money to these institutions who are statutorily required to receive the money and then disburse accordingly.
So, but my point is that if you have a budget deficit that's so large and you are overrunning your revenue collection target, maybe the target is too low.
Oh, that's true. I mean, it's always been the problem.
If you feel if they are able to collect this much and they even do better than you target, it means your target may not be the best.
It reminds me of the time boss made some money and put it everywhere.
You have a lot of stories on the
BNF. Yes! Don't worry, I'll go there. Let me deal with oil and then some other things.
Okay.
So on page three, it says that the first consignment of page three of the Daily Guide, that is, the first consignment of government's oil for gold deal arrived yesterday at the Tema port from Dubai. Daily Guide has learned. The Bulk Oil Storage and Transportation Bus Company is the lead broker of the project, supported by Goyle and other marketing companies. The preliminary consignment, which consists of 40 million metric tons of oil, is expected to be increased subsequently. So we'll keep an eye out on that. Let me take you to the front page of the BNFT, where this rather worrying story about agric production is on page three. Story by Wisdom John Ninuekwe. Food security could be under serious threat with the country increasingly reliant on donor agencies and development partners to fund local agri production and development. This is despite an expected reduction in donor funding support for the country due to the global economic crisis. In 2022, some 26% of the sector's budget was funded by these agencies and DPs. But in 2023, 40% of the sector is expected to be funded by donors, while government picks up the rest of the tap. A very worrying trend. This also brings into sharp focus government's much-touted Ghana Beyond Aid agenda. With what with much of what is consumed already imported, then goes on to list rice, tomato, potato, tomato paste, poultry, other meat products, etc. One could expect that what is produced locally will be funded by government and local private sector to offer some hope of becoming self-sufficient in food production. But the continuous reliance on donor benevolence paints a rather grim picture of what is to come.
Stay with BNFT. There are two more positive stories. Monthly pensions
up by 25%.
Salaries up 30%.
On page two, the SNIT has increased monthly pension payments by an average of 25% for the year. The upward adjustment, which will take effect this month, reflects changes in inflation and minimum wage, SNET said, adding that also factored in the fund's sustainability. So this is affecting some 234,000 legitimate pensioners. Okay. Now on page three, government and trade unions last week, thus they agreed to increase all public servant salaries by 30% for 2023. Okay. So that's
I hope that
good
applies
news.
To us too. But we are public. We are serving the public. Let's continue the headline.
If you go back to the Ghanaian Times, there's a story about bushfire causing major power outage. And if you go to the Chronicle, there's an advertorial there or advertisement on page 9 talking about how the Electricity Company of Ghana is concerned about bush burning. So let me take the...
I've seen, even in Accra, if you, look, you go to the Shiashi media, somebody has burnt the whole place.
It's senselessly. I don't know why they do that. Whether they are chasing Bela or something.
Bush fires contributed to the drought in the 80s.
Exactly.
So we should be very careful.
Yep. And the advertorial says that bush burning and outages. Now, the Electricity Company of Ghana Limited has noticed with great concern the uncontrolled activity of bush burning, especially during the Harmattan season, which adversely impacts on the quality of power supply. Now, these uncontrolled setting of fire to clear bushes end up burning our network system, resulting in outages and inconveniences to our customers. This also puts a heavy toll on our limited finances. Please be informed that ECG reserves the right to seek legal redress against offenders whose activities destroy our installations.
The power was supposedly restored, but last night we had power outage again. So I'm not sure if
there
have
been issues. And in fact, the story basically in the Ghanaian Times says that the Ghana Grid Company has said a raging bushfire under its high voltage near Takwa caused some power line trips, leading to power outage in most parts of the country. Now, many parts of Ghana served by the Electricity Company of Ghana, whose power is supplied by Gridco, encountered the outage at about 11:57 a.m. on Saturday.
Let me do some politics for you, Bernard. The MPP race and ministerial reshuffles running all over the place. On page three of the Daily Guide, names pop up in ministerial reshuffle, and some of the names making the rounds in the are that energy ministry may be steered by KT Amon Kobna Tahir.
I can tell you for free that he was unlikely to take that position.
There's also a returnee to the government as Brian Achampong, MP for Abetifi and former Minister of State at the Ministry of National Security, will be in charge of food and agri, replacing Dr. Osue Friakutu, who resigned to pursue his presidential... Oh, Daily Guy says, rumors have it that his presidential campaign... Come now, listen to this. Rumors have it that his presidential campaign is struggling to get traction. Oh. Not even in his Kwadaso backyard.
Oh, many of you.
Yeah, so those are some of the names that have come up.
I've also seen
details
a picture
later
of Dr. Stephen Amor and John Buedu in the anchor. So the anchor says, KT Hammond, Buedu, others penciled for injury time substitution. And as you said, they're saying KT Hammond is being penciled for a big position. Sky says he doesn't think he will accept it. Brian Achampong, according to the paper, being penciled for another position. We are also told that the John Buedu, whose quest to retain his position as general secretary was dashed, is allegedly set to replace Dr. Efri Akoto as food and agri minister. So it's the same position you mentioned. And then they also talk about Stika Stephen Amoah also being penciled for one position or the other. We'll see how this pans out.
Yeah, they also say that the energy ministry might also witness some changes because NAPU might move to health ministry to replace Kukwaji Maminu. So quite a few things happening there.
Well, let me take you to the Republic Press so we stay in the area of politics. Mahama is attacking Alan Cash. And the details of the story are that former President John Dramani Mahama, on the recent resignations of some ministers of state, has described it as impotent. Now, in a tweet on Friday, January 13, Mahama said, "It is aimless for ministers to be stepping down on roles they were assigned, to not forgetting the past part they played in driving the economy of the country into economic devastation. So basically saying that we will not forget as a people the role that they played over the past 7 years or so in the administration of this country. And even if they resign, we would still hold them to
now,
it.
Now, GMPC is currently exploring its hydrocarbon, the hydrocarbon prospect. Activity
oil in the
Voltaire. Of Ghana's onshore sedimentary basin, the Voltaian. You were right, Voltaian basin. The headline said the headline said Voltaian.
Okay.
Yeah. The prospectivity exploration is being conducted under a reconnaissance license through a mix of geophysical, geological, and geochemical techniques. According to CEO Opoku Awinia Dankwa, I wanted to say it was another day, but because of you, I won't say it. The corporation is looking forward to crown our efforts by drilling a well in Q3, in Q4 2023. You know, guys, our oil prospects have really underperformed. And if there's prospect of getting oil, provided it's done the right way.
Yeah, we've mismanaged the money too.
Very much so, if you look at the PIAC reports. But I'll tell you that oil's performance, look at when Kufuor was about to leave office and all the things said about First Oil.
Charlie.
And all the lessons that we were told and how we ignored everything.
The trips to Norway and all these places.
Yeah, but Mr. Opoku Dankwa made this known at the 2023 Ghana Oil and Gas Roadshow on Thursday in London. And the Voltaian Basin is Ghana's only inland basin and for several decades remained less explored compared to the offshore basins. It is large, occupying about 40% of the total landmass of Ghana, about 40,000 square miles. And the CEO made the point that they are exploring the possibility of hitting oil.
You know, the challenge with that is that because it is not, you know, offshore and it's inland, then it has its own problems because you are going to be affecting people's property, people's land, people's farms, and all of these things. So it's going to be a huge, huge, huge challenge if we're to hit oil in commercial quantities in these areas and then we'll
how to manage it.
Yeah.
Let me give you two quick stories from the Herald newspaper on page 5. The Accra High Court, the High Court in Accra has declined a request from the lawyers of the founder of Beige Bank to cross-examine a principal state witness in the case for 2 months, saying they can only get 12 hours. Mike Nineku is before the court, presided over by Justice Efiase Wasaribuchi, a court of appeal judge sitting as an additional high court judge. We'll give you details on that. And on the same page, MTN Group Limited, Africa's largest wireless carrier, has confirmed receipt of a $773 million back tax bill, including penalties and interest charges in Ghana that it plans to fight.
So that's they feel it's unfair, and they say they've been, and in fact, the records show that they've been Ghana's like most prolific taxpayer for a while. So watch that space for business news.
And then the last one I'll give you, Bernard. So Black Galaxies, no. I like people so they lose. Comoros squad. Madagascar. Charlie, yesterday the goal squad. I don't know if you pronounce it.
But you know, you said something in the past that football, the gap in football has reduced.
Yesterday they tiki taka dasu. Charlie, do it.
You know, if you have a good coach,
if you have a hopeless league here in Ghana, how are you going to?
Oh, Scott, you can't say that.
Oh, but is the truth.
But it's just 2-1. But it's
just 2-1.
Everybody has
it. It is our pride that they are putting there. Did you watch the match?
But what tells you that Madagascar they are standing?
No, but did you watch? You see, that is what we are Ghana. Madagascar. You see,
there's nothing like we are Ghana. It's a figment of your imagination.
Our excellence we must show across the board.
But the excellence has declined. I'm here, Madagascar.
That's the point I'm making. We can't be. We will blast us. Ain't in that time.
Yeah, chow Aloski, chow Abate. Abate.
Thank you, Mrs. Sky.
Hey, Ghana.
Thank you, Godfred Akotoboafo. That was the newspaper review. It's 7:04. Coming up next is the City Business News.
This is the City Breakfast Show, the city's biggest conversation.
Well, sorry to interrupt this program for a break.
region. So suspected jihadists have abducted 50 women in Burkina Faso. That's very close to home. And in Nigeria as well, there's been an attack in a church at Katsina where 25 worshippers had been kidnapped. So quite a number of security stories of concern in the West African sub-region that we did not mention in a newspaper review. Maybe we'll spend some time on that in subsequent programming. City Business News is coming up next. Is brought to us by your OMC of choice, Goyle. We keep making life ever so convenient. We now accept Momo for all fuel purchases. Remember to Momo it at Goyle. Now, you can also use your bank card, that is all bank cards, to buy fuel at Goyle. Drive to the nearest Goyle station now, buy your fuel and pay by Momo, bank card, or Goyle Go card. Visit our Facebook, Instagram, or Twitter pages for more information. Goyle, good energy. Go, yeah, yeah, dear. Michael Ogbodu is here. City Business News at 7. Good morning, Mike.
Good morning, Bernard. Hello and welcome to the breakfast edition of City Business News, proudly brought to you by MTN, Goyle Enterprise Life, your advantage, Access Bank, Modern Banking, and powered by your most comprehensive business news website, citybusinessnews.com. My name is Michael Obodu. And let's head straight into our stories. And the Ghana Revenue Authority, GRA, is encouraging taxpayers to fulfill their obligations under the tax laws to declare and pay the right amount of taxes. It has also reiterated its mandate to ensure that all businesses pay the right amount of tax. This comes on the back of reactions by Scancom PLC MTN Ghana to a statement from the GRA which indicated that it had underdeclared its revenue by more than 30% over the five-year period, that is 2014 to 2018. The assessment was for an amount of about 8.2 billion Ghana cedis, including penalties and interest charges. MTN Ghana, however, believes that the taxes due have been paid during the period under assessment. Now, away from that, 3 years into the commencement of the African Continental Free Trade Area Agreement, the Ghana Union of Traders Associations, GUTA, is urging African leaders to grab the bull by the horn and implement the tariff-free arrangement under the agreement. Trading began under the agreement on the 1st of January 2019, but it has been met with challenges with the implementation of the free tariff policy. Speaking to City Business News, President of GUTA, Dr. Joseph Obing, stressed that governments on the continent must show commitment to ensure AFTA sees the light of day.
One major thing that needs to be considered, and the African leaders have to be bold about it, is that tariff-free should be tariff-free. It shouldn't be made to be staggered, because already the other countries that we do our business have the advantage in pricing and all that. And so if we are not able to remove the tariffs at all, they are still more competitive. The products that we source from outside the continent, African continent, is even more affordable than that is being produced here, even with the duties that we pay. So in that case, people might not be so keen and enthused to buy from within Africa. But the only thing that will help boost this African intertrade is the tariff-free. So they have to remove it. They have to be bold, rather than saying that they want to stagger it over 5 years, 10 years, and all that. Those little reductions might not be attractive to the traders in the sovereign their country.
That was the president of the Ghana Union of Traders Association, Dr. Joseph Obing. Now, the Food and Beverages Association of Ghana is lamenting the number of taxes its members have to pay to government. They explain the high tax payment overburdens their businesses, which threatens local production. Speaking on the sidelines of the launch of the 7th edition of the Ghana Beverage Awards in Accra, the General Secretary of the Association, Samuel Agri, called on authorities to be considerate with the number of taxes paid by its members.
It always happens that our taxes is what is militating against these production companies. Now, if you are producing in Ghana, it's not a crime. It's an incentive for the state. And if we export more, it also helps the government for them to raise the needed revenue that would develop this country. Unfortunately, we are paying so much taxes and the policies are not helping. if we have to say there's something that we need to do, then we have to look at the taxes that we are imposing on these manufacturers. We don't have to do that in the sense that if we are producing most of these products in this country, or we are enticing manufacturers to come into this country to produce, then we need to put them under a certain category where they can produce, make some profits, and then put them back into their production. We are not saying we should have the field of the day by reducing taxes, just by reducing them. Taxes must be reduced by benchmarking the production that we also do, by employment that we also do. If we do that, we can go ahead and match any other country that are producing into this country. When you go out there into the international market, most of them are producing at a lower cost because they have those incentives put in place for them to be able to produce and then export.
Samuel Agri is the General Secretary of the Food and Beverage Association of Ghana. Now, the General Secretary of the Chamber of Automobile Dealership Ghana, George Dumenu, has appealed to the government to return the duties paid on the vehicles seized by IOCO to help save dealers from losses. The Economic and Organized Crime Office on December 9, 2022 raided some garages and seized 37 imported luxury vehicles suspected to be stolen from America and Canada. Speaking to City Business News on the sidelines of a stakeholders' engagement with other security agencies, Mr. Dumenu described the affected dealers as victims.
Before you're able to clear one car, it's huge sums of money. So for somebody, you know, it may be you, it may be me. Some of you may need, they want nice car to ride on. You go to the net, you see that this car is beautiful, you buy it, and when you come, and this issue of theft, you thought that you are doing a genuine business. So when this issue came like that, most of us, as your sister station was asking me that, some people even started giving threats to the government because it is out of frustration. All your resources have been, you know, dashed to this, that's been just like that. So the government should come to our aid, and if possible, the money that we are paid to, what do you call it, the custom, should be refunded to us.
Well, that was George Dumenu, who is the General Secretary of the Automobile Dealers Association. Now, moving on, some financial institutions have expressed worry over government's amendment to the debt exchange program and its timelines. They posted that the current form of the program will have dire implications for their businesses. In an interview with City Business News, Managing Director of FBN Bank Ghana, Victor Yawasanti, notes that though the banks have been engaging relevant stakeholders and the government on the way forward, more needs to be done.
We've been engaging all players, which will be the government. The government is the one who's basically rolling it out. And whatever they do, they have implications for us and therefore our regulators as well. So there's been a lot of engagement since the announcement was made. Indeed, government has pretty much wrapped up on what it wants to change. There's been a lot of back and forth from the bankers' perspective, which is fed into some of the changes that came through. So that has also happened. So we wait to see. It's 16th, so I have a few days to go, so wait to see. We are now going to bake in all the changes and so on and see how it pans out. It has many implications. There's liquidity problems. Banks are worried that we may not have liquidity because most banks, if we really implement it the way they've said, we won't have liquidity. So those are part of the engagements we've been having with the regulator and central bank about how we manage the liquidity. Because if we don't have liquidity, we can't support the private sector. So those are things that we need to do. We have to see how we can get some forbearance around some of the requirements of a regular bank, and these are the things we are working on with them. Else, yes, it will affect the private sector. So those are the things we are working on.
On Ghana's request for debt relief through the G20 Common Framework Program, Mr. Victor Asante said that even though it may bring some relief, it cannot save the country from the economic crisis.
Well, if they give it to us, we'll be very happy. We can't pay, and therefore we're in trouble. So if there will be cancellation, it's also one of the conversations that go on when people are distressed, whether some of it can be forgiven. So if we can get that forgiveness, all the better. But for now, what's on the table is for the debt exchange, which basically means that you term out or you try to, we are in default, as it were, we are in default. And we're just having an agreement, orderly agreement, to try and pay back what we owe over a period of time through a negotiation. So that's what is on the table. Well, we owe money. So if your debtor forgives you, you're happier. It means that you don't owe anymore. You can go back to your normal business and perhaps the program would not run as long as we thought it would. But for now, we are in a serious position. We are not generating as much as we should generate in terms of debt service.
That was the managing director of FBN Bank Ghana, Victor Yao Asante. Now, on the interbank foreign exchange market, where banks trade amongst themselves, the dollar gained 1 cedi 34 pesos and is selling at 10 cedis 34 pesos. The British pound gained 1 cedi 52 pesos and is selling at 12 cedis 62 pesos. The euro gained 1 cedi 5 pesos and is selling at 11 cedis 2 pesos. However, at some forex bureaus in the capital, the dollar is selling at 12 cedis 80 pesos and the British pound is selling at 13 cedis 10 pesos. Let's now join Mark Jordan Sikanate of Data Bank for the latest updates on the stock market.
Four price movers were registered on the markets last week. Total Energies and New Gold featured as price gainers, while Unilever Ghana and Cowbank PLC recorded price decline. Following this, the GSE Composite Index retreated by 0.21% week on week to 2,438.74 points, while the Data Bank Stock Index also flipped 0.41% week on week to 104.89 points. This week, with Sibbenz Oil Palm Plantation and Total Energies to make gains due to increased demand for their shares. However, we expect gold to decline on prevailing selling pressures. MTN Ghana and New Gold should drive market activity this week.
That was Mark Jordan Sikanate of Data Bank. And that does it for the breakfast edition of City Business News, proudly brought to you by MTN, Goal, Enterprise Life, Your Advantage, Access Bank, Modern Banking, and powered by your most comprehensive business news website, citybusinessnews.com. My name is Michael Obudu. Have a good business day. Thank you for listening. As always, please stay safe.
Join the conversation on the City Breakfast Show on Facebook at facebook.com/city97.3, Twitter at twitter.com/city973, and Instagram at instagram.com/city973 with the hashtag CityCBS. This is the City Breakfast Show, the city's biggest conversation.
Things versus the government saying, you know what, if you're not going to do the debt exchange, things like road construction would suffer, infrastructure development would suffer. We'll try and resolve that for you during the show today, because there's a lot of pressure. 16th January, we don't know how many people have taken up the offer yet. Meanwhile, contractors say they are owed up to 6 billion cedis. 6 billion Ghana cedis. In the meantime, kickoff is next, and I don't even know what is happening to Liverpool Football Club. I mean,
I told you people long time ago. Said I was pessimistic. I was a naysayer.
Oh Lord. Outplayed, outfought, outthought, outscored.
And it wasn't just yesterday. It wasn't just this weekend.
Yes, last weekend as well.
It's been all season, actually. Liverpool have always gone down first in a game. Then they'll try and fight back. Sometimes they'll get a last-minute equalizer. Sometimes it won't work.
Are these just natural cycles?
I want to believe so. I mean, if Klopp's team have played at an elite level for like 5 years,
so they are tired.
It's only natural that there should have been a proper reboot.
And is that not what differentiates Sir Alex Ferguson from the rest? Because I watched Alex Ferguson for a period of 13 years where there was practically no dip, where he would
he would
always refresh the team.
Even Guardiola, you're going too far. I mean, look. As you go along, you need to buy players to replace. And one thing about Klopp I always complain about is running players into the ground. If Robertson is not injured, he will play 5 years until he's injured.
So he doesn't know how to manage.
He does not trust the second option to come in and do the same job until it's a lower profile game. Mm. And so it's just very hard. But, you know, Guardiola is winning 3 seasons. He just won a title. But you can see him consciously trying to buy a replacement for an Aguero or trying to buy a replacement for a De Bruyne just so in case if De Bruyne gets injured for half the season, he has a contingency plan. Liverpool don't have the same, you know.
Meanwhile, back home here, Ghana lost to Madagascar 1-2.
Charlie.
You know, Sky said this is Ghana, but I'm saying, Charlie, I've been a footballer, seniors, Benidorm.
And that's the truth.
Football is now...
You have to wake up and smell the coffee.
I mean, if you're born in Madagascar and you have access to cable TV, you can watch all the best footballers in the world.
You really can.
So there's the gap that used to be there has really reduced.
Yeah.
So we should stop this illusion that we are Ghana. We are nothing. 7:15, kickoff is next, brought to you by Leshego. Now, if you've not updated your record with us yet, per directive from the BOG, the Ghana card is now the only accepted form of ID for all financial transactions. Visit any of our branches to update your records with your Ghana card and enable us to serve you better. Call Leshego via WhatsApp 057-4065958 or call 0302-208-333. Leshego, let's improve life. All right, so Benjamin, take it up.
Well, let's get into the headlines. And Ghana's Black Galaxy suffer shock defeat to Madagascar in opening game of the Chan tournament. Arsenal do the double over Spurs to extend their lead at the top of the EPL table. And in the NBA, there were wins for the Sixers, the Kings, and the Portland Trail Blazers. And let's start off with the ongoing Chan tournament and Ghana's Black Galaxies. They lost by 2-1 to Madagascar in their opening match at the delayed tournament. Now, our guest thing, Japan's 68th minute goal was just a consolation after Walker's side had conceded twice from defensive errors. Ghana will play Sudan in their final group match on Thursday. Now, Group C has 3 teams after Morocco pulled out of the competition. Now, in other Chan games played over the weekend, Algeria, they beat Libya by 1-0. Ethiopia drew goalless with Mozambique. DR Congo played out a goalless draw with Uganda. And then Senegal also beat Cote d'Ivoire by 1-0. Coming up today at 4 p.m. Ghana time, there's Mali versus Angola. There is also a game at 7 p.m. between Cameroon and Congo. Now let's get to the BetPower Premier League match day 12. Accra Hartlepool played out a goalless draw with Samatex Football Club. Let's hear from Accra Hartlepool head coach Slavko Matic after the draw.
Very tough match. You saw, I said before game, I know my players was very tired. On the half was already exhausted. We tried to change something to put fresh legs. But you saw, today, they do maximum. We cannot do more. I can be satisfied with the willing, especially young players. They need time for continuity. And they play a lot of games in short period, as I say. Opponent here 1 day more for rest, and I saw that 90 minutes we can see that when you can't run like you must run, also you tactically don't play very well. This is not game what I expect, what my players and fans expect, but have these games. We'll have now 4 weeks. After 3 weeks we'll have 4 weeks for recovery.
Accra Hearts of Folk head coach, Slavko Matic, speaking there. Let's get to the camp of Samatex and let's hear from their coach, Nassam Abubakar. He was disappointed with the disallowed goal in the match.
I told you earlier on, we'll have a plan, and if it is executed to the full length, we'll get the results. And you saw what happened. I'm not a referee, but I felt it was a clean goal, and the linesman ruled it off. But our plan worked to perfection. We are just one of the newcomers, and playing against Hearts in Accra Sports Stadium and getting a draw is not bad for us. So we'll keep working, and we'll see what happens at the end of the league.
So you had Nassam Abubakar speaking there. Let's get to the other results in the league. Dreams FC 3, RTU 1, Karela FC 1, Adriana Stars 0, King Faisal 1, Tamale City 0. So King Faisal enjoying a bit of a renaissance recently under our coach Jimmy Cobbler. Kotoku Royals, they lost by 2-0 to Great Olympics. They are struggling in the league so far. And Swatraman also played out a goalless draw with Lagos City's Bechem United 1, Mediama 0. And then there was also Bechem United head coach Kasim Mingolo Kanse speaking about the need for everybody to improve after the victory.
Before the commencement of the game, I told you, now that we've been wasteful up front, this is exactly what happened today. Although we were playing all the ball, but what matters most is the goals, and we've been wasting them. So I'll continue working on our goal scoring to see whether we have an improvement over there.
Assistant coach for Mediama, Umar Rabi, expressed his displeasure at the goal they conceded through a penalty.
I don't think this is a fair result. We did our best to contend them, even to get a point from here. If you look at the penalty, it was an inexperience. There was no need for him to go down. Clinton was going away from the shooting angle. Just stay, just cover him and then he will go away. This is another cheap goal. It's just an inexperience. He's all coming right from second division. So you can see.
Assistant coach for Mediama Sporting Club, Umar Rabi, speaking there. Let's get to some of the other games that will be played today. Accra Lions take on Brekum Chelsea. There's Bibiani Gold Stars taking on Kumasi Asante Kotoko. If you get to the league table, Adriana Stars are top of the table, 24 points. Hearts of Folk are second. Third is Bechem United, and Asante Kotoko coming in fourth place. Let's now catch up with action from the English Premier League, an action that took place over the weekend. Let's start off with the North London Derby. It was Arsenal Football Club traveling all the way to their opponents or rivals' home ground to dominate them, beating them by 2-0, picking up all 3 points in the process to open up the lead at the top of the table. Chelsea Football Club were also up against Crystal Palace, and it was Kai Havertz bringing some relief to Chelsea after a long spell of barren results. 1-0 is how that particular game ended. Newcastle United continue to be impressive this season, picked up a lone goal victory, conceded none as well. So their defense continues to be impressive as well. Brentford were also too strong for AFC Bournemouth when they played at home. They won their game by 2-0. Brighton and Hove Albion took the result of the round. They completely whitewashed Liverpool 3-0. How that game ended, Danny Welbeck and Solly March scoring some really brilliant goals in that particular encounter. There was Everton taking on Southampton Football Club. Everton continued to struggle. Southampton also looking to climb out of the bottom places. 2-1 is how that game ended. Nottingham Forest were up against Leicester City. They won that game by 2-0. Wolves beat West Ham by 1-0. Manchester United, in controversial circumstances, recovered to beat their rivals Manchester City by 2-1. And then Aston Villa also picked up a 2-1 win over Leeds United. When you get to the league standings, Arsenal top of the table, 47 points. Only 14 goals conceded. Manchester City are second on 39 points. And then you have Newcastle in third on 38 points. Fourth, United on 38 points as well. And then you have Tottenham completing the top five on 33 points. Sixth is Fulham. Seventh, Brighton. Eighth, Brentford. Ninth, Liverpool. And 10th, Chelsea. These are not places you would have predicted for teams like Liverpool and Chelsea, but that's exactly what it is looking like in the Premier League these days. Let's go to some basketball to round it off for this morning's edition of Kickoff, and let's check out the games that were played last night. The Portland Trail Blazers, they were at home when they beat the Dallas Mavericks 140-123. The Kings continue to be impressive. 132-119 is how they won their game against the San Antonio Spurs. The Kings improved to a 24-18 record. They look like they are ready to get back into the playoffs. The Denver Nuggets were also at home when they beat the Orlando Magic, 119-116. And then a Russell Westbrook gaffe at the end of the game cost the Lakers a victory against the 76ers. 112-113 is how that particular one ended. That's how it broke down in the NBA last night. And that's all for this morning's edition of Kickoff. My name is Benjamin Nketiah. Kickoff was brought to us by Letsheho. There's more sports at citysportsonline.com.
Trust the process. The biggest things often start small. No matter where you are now, the most important decision you will make today is knowing where you'll be tomorrow. All you have to do is take the next step. Believe in your journey and go with passion. Because when you go with passion, you go big. You explore the possibilities. You create the tomorrow of your dreams. So come along and let's go big with our passion. Apply for a loan now and power your ambitions. Get plugged in. Let's go big. Powered by Letsheho.
Letsheho. Join the conversation on the City Breakfast Show on Facebook at facebook.com/city97.3, Twitter at twitter.com/city973, and Instagram at instagram.com/city973 with the hashtag CityCBS.
For Pepsodent, smiles are one of the most important things we have. The problem is, globally, one in two children suffer.
natural mystic could be, whether it's some disease, whether it's some invasion, whether it's a philosophy, whether it's some Armageddon type thing. I don't know what it is.
Balances itself, man.
Yeah, but I don't know. But what is the natural mystic? If you know, let me know. A few more birthday requests coming in. Happy birthday to Joel Nalikem Wright. You are 7 years old today. You are a student of Olive Crest Montessori. Coming in from your mom and dad. May you live to fulfill God's destiny for your life. Joel Nalikem Wright. One of my favorite ever names, guy, is Valikem.
Valikem.
I had a friend called Valikem Dovulu.
Wow.
Valikem. Very nice name, Valikem. Wonderful name. You know, it's a prophetic name. Yeah, Valikem.
Valikem, yeah.
It's a wonderful name. So that's happy, but this is Nalikem.
Yeah, Nalikem.
This is not Valikem. This is Joel Nalikem Wright. He's 7 years old today. His dad and mom and the siblings say, you are a big man.
Mm-hmm. Big man.
Bigger every day. It's one of my favorite songs in my house. Bigger every day. You know who sang it? Oh, Sky, Charlie, you backslide too much. Yeah. Yeah. If like you, Bob Marley, you know. Later, you know who's I'm bigger every day? Bigger every day.
But I know the song, I just don't know who
sang it. What's the progression? You don't know it. You don't know it.
I know the song.
Bigger every day.
Bigger every day. Yeah, I know the song.
It's sung by Moses Bliss.
Moses Bliss.
Yeah. You know Moses Bliss? Hey, Sky, you don't know Moses Bliss?
No, I'm backsliding.
You have to go back to your EP church PO boxes at Avian. No, care of PO Box 6 at Avian. Richard Delasca is a big man.
And let me say belated happy birthday. It's coming from all of us, actually, to Class P De La Russell, Oklu of the Daily Graphic. You celebrated...
Of the Port and Harbor branch.
Thank you, thank you. She is the governance head over there. She is governing the whole place.
Yeah, the whole port. You know, what is left of the port? She's the chief correspondent for Daily Graphic at the port.
Thank you. And the last fantastic woman. Yeah. Charlie, you keep listening to us and keep doing great things for the Republic.
Solid. And it's cool cash for you this season. January is long. That's why you need to get in touch with Zenith Bank and be part of the Zenith Bank MasterCard More for More promo now. Spend 1,000 cedis or more online or via POS using a Zenith MasterCard debit card and be rewarded with fewer coupons, shopping vouchers, and up to 20,000 cedis cash at the end of January. Eish. Shop and pay using a Zenith MasterCard debit card and be rewarded with a cool cash to shop again in the Zenith for More promotion. Promo regulated by NLA on the Caritas Lottery platform. Terms and conditions apply. Promo ends January 31, 2023. Zenith Bank, in your best interest. Later on this morning on Effective Living Series, I'll be speaking to Taka Awori. And this week, we're focusing on your professional priorities. And she'll be discussing the issue of self-leadership in the new world of work. Taka Awori is the founder and CEO of Busara Africa, which is a leading human and organizational development consultancy. She's always one of my best speakers. She's launched a new book called Leadership. Tuning at 9 a.m. on the City Breakfast Show and at 9:30 on City TV Breakfast Daily. So that's coming up this morning. Also, it's brought to you by Enterprise Insurance and Hallmark Freight and Logistics. This year's Enterprise Motor Insurance promo is different. Simply buy or renew your motor insurance with Enterprise and win instant gifts such as fuel coupons, branded gift items, and qualify for the monthly raffle draw with amazing rewards. What's more, when you buy your motor insurance from Enterprise, you stand a chance of winning an iPhone 14 washing machine, high-pressure car washer, vacuum cleaner, auto tire inflator, and in the final month, a premium crotch rocket motorbike. Wait no more. Call your insurance broker, your agent, or visit any Enterprise branch for your motor insurance. Get free fuel coupons and be the possible winner of these amazing rewards at our monthly raffle draw between January and June. Enterprise, your advantage.
the Ghana Armed Forces aged gracefully in good health. This one is from Abel Tete. Mm-hmm. And please wish our daughter and sister, Lois Omanye Yo Oblie, I think, happy birthday from the father and mother and sisters, Phoebe Na, Dromo, and Ariel Yehoada, all of the Oblie family. This one says, happy birthday to my dear son, Lemuel Coleman. He's 8 today. The message is coming from his father, George Coleman. And Bernard, please help me wish my small girl, Bryna, Sedem Agro, a belated birthday. She's a level 6 student in one of the schools in the Volta region. That's coming from her uncle, Ebenezer Agro. Mm-hmm. And kindly wish my lovely superhero husband, engineer Adam Apedo of Doron Medical Center, Fienya, happy birthday. Mm. Please tell him I said he's still the one. That's from his wife, Vivian Apedo.
Speaking of Vivian, I want to wish Vivian Kai Loco.
A.K.A. Labadi Lejone Jack.
A.K.A. Shine Shine Bobo. A.K.A. Riri. He has many names. Yesterday was her birthday.
Yesterday was a gargantuan birthday.
We want to just join ourselves to all the wishes and send special notice to Ninja.
Thank you.
And that he knows what to do.
Yeah.
Being an experienced man. he knows the protocol.
Thank you. He should advise himself.
So Ninja, you know what you have to do. On behalf of the Absuni, where is he from, Seth?
Adisco.
Yes. Adisco man. So
Santa Claus.
He's doing it for it on our behalf.
No, I mean, whatever you do one for me. Happy birthday, Vivian Kailoko. You're a big woman.
Final one. It says, it's yet another beautiful day to celebrate a special woman. And this one is going out to Mrs. Gloria Nafu Asante of the Methodist University College. You are not only my dearest wife, but also the best thing that ever happened to me. May the good Lord grant you all your heartfelt birthday wishes. Enjoy a fabulous birthday, and I pray that all you wish for come through. This is coming in from your husband, the belated one. And the name is Gabriel Asante, West African Institute for Financial and Economic Management inside Lagos, Nigeria.
All right, so the government gave itself an 80% target for the domestic debt exchange.
Okay.
It is quite clear that they have not met that. On Friday, there was a crunch meeting between the Minister of Finance and his advisors on one side and the various group of financial institutions who have been invited to take up the debt exchange program. This is the second deadline. And even though I have not received an official notification, I can tell you that based on all that I know, it is unlikely that the government has met its 80%. I'm not even sure they've met 50% of uptakes. Mm-hmm. So it is very likely they would extend the debt exchange program deadline. And there are various theories as to how we got here. My theory is twofold. I think that the debt exchange was rushed so that the consultations that ought to have been done. You recall we read the Jamaican example. There's also been examples in Ecuador and other parts of the world, Argentina, Sri Lanka. You typically would have a longer period of consultation so that the announcement of the debt exchange is just a formality. You remember when I was reading the Jamaican example, I said to you that there's this whole consultation, there is a committee formed. So for me, the first red flag was when people in the industry started calling me a day before the announcement in absolute panic. It's like the government is proposing very draconian terms for a debt exchange, which they do not seem to agree with.
Yeah.
Now, that's the first red flag, because for the few debt exchanges we've read about, you would typically talk to everybody, discuss the details, form a set of committees, and the day you are making the announcement, the guys from the other institutions are flanking you so that those of us who are watching will say, the bank association guy is there, insurance guy is there, fund management guy is there. So this is something they've agreed and worked through. Two things happened. We put in place a high-level committee. I'm not sure we used anything.
That's where my red flag came from.
Oh, so that's your red flag?
That was my red flag.
Okay.
The fact that we did not hear anything about the work that commission did after.
Mm.
And as soon as that happened for me, I was like, there's a problem.
There's a problem.
Because again, based on the kind of people we had on that particular commission that was set out to go and do the work, if they had come out to say, this is what we've done and these are our recommendations based on the conversations we've had and we spoke to the finance ministry, ABCD, perhaps we would have seen, because then we could have used that committee or commission as a liaison, as a bridge. Because if you look at the people who are on it, you mentioned Mr. Essien.
Alex Asiedu.
Mr. Asiedu,
a high level insurance lady.
Lady on it. All these people had links back to
Simon Donu.
Yes, back to the affected parties. They would have been able to sort this out.
So that was your red flag.
That was my red flag.
My red flag, the first one was the fact that industry people appeared surprised about this. And then the second issue was the, what do you call back and forth in English? Like you say something, you renege on it. So the president comes and says there's not going to be a haircut.
Cut.
And then the information minister has to come and explain that it's going to be his principal. Then you have the president saying that domestic bondholders will not be included. And so individual bonds are not included and even included. So there are a lot of U-turns. The lack of clarity from the beginning was a red flag. Because as I said, usually you would have worked all these things through so that when you announce it, it's just a formality. We seem to have made the announcement and now different groups started protesting. Pensions say, we will not agree. And then you had insurance saying, please exclude us. The bank said, we'll be collapsed. You collapse us if you do this the way you want to do it. The fund managers say, you wipe out the whole industry. Then individual bondholders are brought in. I think the first watershed moment was when the individual bondholders came in. It mobilized them around the cause. Because prior to that, a lot of the opposition had been institutional. And you know that a lot of these banks and things cannot really oppose the government because the regulator is very strong. But individual bondholders, the government has nothing on them. So whoever advised the government to include individual bondholders either doesn't understand the way Ghana works or is very heartless. Because if you really understand the way Ghana works, it's once you see, individual bondholders are typically influential people who are wealthy. And there's also a lot of pensioners involved who know how to mobilize. Indeed, as I speak to you, no meaner person than Dr. Edouard Anienchi, one of the most accomplished people in finance, interviewed him many times. Edouard Anienchi is the former CEO or the MDG of the SEC.
He knows what he's talking about.
Representing individual bondholders. And he says, all that we've told people to do in my past 30 years of work will be undone if this thing goes through the way it is being done. So the consultation was poor. And whoever gave the advice, and that's the other challenge. I don't want to criticize the foreign consultants because there's a lot of technical work that needs to be done when it comes to debt exchanges. But there's always an important cultural context that these international organizations miss, where they think they can run roughshod or just make recommendations without being cognizant of some of the nuances. Nobody who understands the way Ghana works would just come up with the way they announce this and include individual bondholders when the president has been very clear that they are not going to do it. You are even undermining his credibility by doing that. So I feel that the Ministry of Finance has not taken, and indeed, the third point I'll make, and again, I stand to be corrected, listening to the big issue very carefully this weekend, and Fred, you can correct me if I'm wrong, I have the distinct impression that the vice president's spokesperson was a bit conflicted in his submissions. He did not seem very sure. He did not seem very, he was not decisive. He was very imprecise in answering also the questions that the panel was putting to him.
A lot of his answers did not give confidence.
Yes, and I am saying that to suggest that where he's taking his direction from, which is the vice president's office, head of the EMT, may not be in total agreement with the way the finance ministry is proceeding. Because the gentleman was speaking for the vice president. He wasn't speaking for the Minister of Finance. So when he was pushed, he found a nice way around some of the questions. So I'm using that to say that, and again, if you look at the way high-level members of parliament know mean a person than the majority leader, and then the majority chief whip, you know parliament, for a majority leader who I know is under pressure, all right? A majority leader who is under pressure because of some of the moves to remove the finance minister, and a chief whip whose job it is to mobilize the government side in parliament to support government programs, to separate interviews, indeed, Fred, I have the interview played. To in separate interviews, say that if you include the individual bondholders, you wipe out the middle class. Now, that is either possibility, the possibility is either a high level of disagreement in government, Because a majority leader knows that whatever he says is very serious. So for him to say this and for the chief to support it, it tells me that either the finance minister is on his own in this matter, and there are people in government who are saying, you are going against what we've decided, which is why they have come out. Because there's no reason why a majority leader will come out and openly say that if you include individual bondholders, you wipe out the middle class. Basically, pointing the finance minister in the face and saying, what you are doing is wrong. Both of them are in cabinet. So the only explanation is that the Minister of Finance and Lazar are on their own, or Mr. Chimensa Bonsu and Anodon Pre Omar Titin. And the latter is not possible. Because in this circumstance, they can't teach in like that. There has to be some schism in government for two high-level officials of government to openly oppose the position of the Ministry of Finance. Sky.
Well, I mean, so if you understand the history behind how bondholders came to be included in this whole thing, I mean, it's not what you see publicly, but there's a lot that goes on behind the scenes. Mind you, initially they were not part of it. But the resistance that we've seen from, you know, trade unions and some other organized groups to the initial approach or the initial announcement, okay, they wanted to include pensions and all other things, which eventually had to be chopped off, led to a rethink what should be the new approach. Now, of course, there are some reasons why, and when you speak to people within government and those on the corridors of power, you get the impression that there are a lot of big boys within government who wield so much financial power and who have invested heavily in bonds. The impression is created that some of these big boys, so-called big boys, have been putting pressure on the finance ministry in a number of ways. Either they are, you know, organizing people against the finance minister for non-performance or incompetence, as some have suggested, or that they are creating the kind of atmosphere that makes it impossible for the finance minister to perform his job because they do not like his style of governance. So you hear from some people, their indication that, okay, this attempt to include individual bondholders is in part to deal with the problem and then also to punish those people who are deemed to be some of the biggest investors in the bonds. And who are in government, and who are not in government, strictly speaking, but who either members of parliament or members of the party, and who have invested heavily in bonds. So if you want to neutralize them, at least for the next 2 years, you have to do something about the funds that come to them from the bonds that they have invested in. So,
seriously?
Oh, Bernard.
So you are looking at it more from the fact that these guys are fighting for their own money.
Yeah, so there's a context to it.
Okay.
And the context is that, as you said, the Honorable Say Chairman Sabonsu is facing pressure, which pressure is resulting from a certain suspicion that he may have had something to do with the attempt to topple the finance minister. He himself has come out to say that he was surprised at the coup d'etat launch at the finance minister. Of course, I mean, there are people in government who think otherwise. Okay. Do you understand? So it is not surprising to have him come out. If the earlier submission I made is anything to go by, then it will create the impression that, look, he is putting pressure back on the system to say that, look, you cannot go after the funds of these people. But you see, we have to make an admission.
Yeah, hold on. But he would only be bold enough to do this if he knows that there are people in the same government who support it.
Yeah, that's what I'm
because
saying.
Because if it was just a question of his personal money, then his position would be completely untenable.
Yeah.
Because first, you're accused of trying to ask the finance minister or instigating this, that you haven't even finished paying yourself off. And then you come out and openly, and mind you, from the government's communication, if the domestic debt exchange fails, at least if Gabby's tweets are to be believed, the IMF program will not happen. Which means that government, in fact, the 2023 budget hinges on this. Now, the majority leader in parliament who oversaw the approval of the budget, who is in charge of making sure government business goes through, is now openly saying that including this group will wipe out the middle class, basically saying your approach is wrong. So I can only conclude that somebody in government, probably higher than him, wants him to do this.
You see, that's what I'm saying. That if you know the history of how the finance minister came to be hit so hard by members of his own party, saying that we don't want him as finance minister again, then you would understand that within the party structures, within the MPP in parliament, there are big boys who control a lot of money. And these so-called big boys have invested heavily, according to the information that is circulating, in bonds. And these were the same people who someway, somehow, according to the information, met somewhere in the eastern region and had...
But that would be so cynical.
Hold on, Ben.
They are including them because they want to...
So you see,
want to sacrifice our economic survival as a government on emasculating a few miscreant MPs who have money. That's cynical.
No, hold on. First, it will not be too much of a stretch considering... Considering that we put policies in place to benefit five people.
No.
But whole state policy.
No, I see. Guys.
So what Sky is saying is not too much of a stretch.
Lazard Frere is one of, I don't know the preferers or whatever their names. Uh-huh. They are a global, known agency that helps countries to do, in fact, they help Ecuador do their debt exchange.
Yeah.
World Bank, IMF, and all these bodies are part of the conversation about debt exchange. It's a major conversation.
Yeah.
You want to tell me that one of the considerations of whoever is pushing this is to immobilize people with money in the government.
It's not too much of a stretch.
Come on, guys.
You see, but Bernard, there are significant differences between... And if you realize, civil society has not been very happy with how this process, including all these partners that you've mentioned, have gone about this particular debt exchange program. Because if you look at the last engagement Ghana had with the IMF, civil society and other actors were kept very much in the loop on every step of the way. In fact, they made inputs along the way.
So under the previous government?
Yes. Okay. It's not even about the government's problem. I'm just saying the last process.
The last process, okay.
So this one, the finance ministry is...
This one is like, they've put a lead wall around it.
Maybe because the ministry feels isolated.
Bernard.
How does the ministry feel isolated when you are talking about people's money?
Let me just try and see if I can get. So the Ministry of Finance is the one that all these agencies will take a cue from.
Mm-hmm.
So I understand that the external forces will depend on the Ministry of Finance for local context.
Mm-hmm.
Right. But I'm saying that the decision to include individual bondholders, if you read the statement that they sent, they said that because they have varied the terms, and they have made the terms less inimical, they were going to include individual bonus. So they were not saying that they were just making a U-turn. They said, if you read the statement on Friday or Thursday, they said, initially we have only 4 flat bonds. We've increased them to 12. The terms were very liquid. We have made them into a combination of less liquid and more liquid. And we feel that with those terms, we are inviting individual bondholders.
Yeah.
Now, I think that's very nuanced.
No, you see, Bernard, that's why I'm saying that. You see, you don't just look at it on the periphery. You see, it's just, basically it's perfunctory for a government to issue a statement and say that, okay, this is the reason we are doing this now. But I'm saying that there's always a history to it. And if you understand the context of how people want the finance minister to go, you understand the context of the alleged coup plot, how it was plotted. If you understand the weight of people who reportedly financed it, if you understand how those people came to be, if you like, in parliament, when the minister responsible for finance, who they had said should go, came back to the chamber in order to listen to the finance minister present his budget, then you will understand why some people take the view.
Okay, so some people are taking the view. It's not as if you are concluding.
No. I'm not concluding. I'm just telling you what is happening on the corridors.
Exactly. Some claim that the man wants to do them in.
Exactly. So, and these are people with a lot of financial, muscle. So, how do you make sure that they do not become a problem going forward? Mind you, there are elections to be fought. Which elections will elect a flag bearer and then ultimately elect a president? That is if the MPP's fortunes are to be seen as being solid strong ahead of the 2024 elections. So what I'm saying is that it did not just happen out of a vacuum. Of course, there was an initial approach, which approach some people resisted. So if you take those people out, the thing is in no longer in balance. So when that happens, what is the next feasible alternative? Which is to say, how do we bridge the gap in there? Okay. And then they decided to go against, if you like, go and do a research and find out who are the biggest individual bondholders in Ghana. The people who have invested so much money in bonds. I'm not talking about the ones who are, you know, making serious demands on the sidelines. Yeah. There are big boys who have political colors, who have invested so much money, and they are out for blood.
All right, I'll play Clemenza's voice for you and then come back and see what Gabby has been tweeting as well.
Before you do, hold on. 1 second. You see, just because of what Sky is saying, guess who met the party over the weekend?
No, they came to greet him. Sky, I want us to be careful here because, see, I think that...
No, I know.
The way the government's in a desperate position.
Oh, yes.
That's true.
And so... What you ask, you've qualified what you said by saying that some people think that he put it, they brought this in because of those cynical reasons. But trust me, even the Minister of Finance's company will suffer because of this. So it's not as if anybody is going to benefit from this debt exchange.
Oh, certainly.
Apart from the fact that maybe because of the only question you can ask about this debt exchange is that those who knew about it ahead of time, could they have exited and made big sums of money before all of us who didn't know would suffer? And in serious jurisdictions, those things must be investigated. So, for example, you can have a right information to say, okay, let's know 6 months prior to the debt exchange and IMF program, how many of the private or domestic or individual bondholders cashed out significant amounts of money on the basis of knowing that there was going to be a debt exchange.
Foreknowledge.
That could be very important going forward to determine whether or not some of the things you're saying are true. I want to hear the man himself, Chairman Sabon. So he was speaking as a brief voice clip.
If we are wiping away the middle class, that's going to be dangerous. That's going to be dangerous. So we need to have some further dialogue on this. I'm not sure the government is, you know, takes interest and joy in suppressing. No government would have any joy in doing that. So government thinks that this is the best way forward. However, even if it is, we need to engage, pause, reflect, and then move on. And then that will encourage people who have some doubts to better appreciate where we are. Because some people are talking out of emotions, not really appreciating where we are.
So that was Chairman Sabon. It was a shortish voice clip. I'm being careful to... You cannot disengage the politics from the economics.
Yep.
But I feel we'll do our listeners a lot of justice if we break down the economic reasons why this is not working.
Yeah.
The fact that the terms are inimical. And even though the government has made improvements, if you put the whole thing together, a lot of groups still feel they'll be worse off. The banking sector feels that their capital is going to go, their liquidity is going to go, a lot of that. We can deal with all of that.
Yeah.
And then we come to the politics of it as well, the lack of consultation, the approach of take it or leave it initially, the attorney general's advice, and then the attempt to remove the Minister of Finance and the issue of trying to emasculate private domestic bondholders and all of those as another. Because, Kai, I agree with you that there's something they call political economy that is studied seriously. Mm-hmm. You're basically saying that it's not just the economics.
Yeah.
The politics around it is also important. So I get you. But I'm just saying that it will be very surprising for that to be the main consideration for this U-turn. Because if a president comes to announce that there's not going to be individual bondholders, and anybody who understands Ghana politics knows that once you bring in individual bondholders, they have less fear of government. It's not like banks or insurance companies or groups of companies. These are private people who have made their own money.
Yeah.
So whoever took that decision is probably very naive about social mobilization in Ghana and does not understand. I mean, look at what Senyo Hosi and Martin Kwebu and Edouard Anenchi have been able to do in 1 week. I mean, I came on air in November and we started talking about debt exchange. We have not had a serious advocacy against debt exchange until individual bondholders were mentioned less than 2 weeks ago. And what they've managed to achieve, they've gotten over 30,000 signatures in a week. The banks were shouting, but they were not on air. They were afraid. Insurance companies were screaming, but they were screaming on phone using WhatsApp messages. They couldn't come on air. So whoever made the calculation that let's bring in individual bondholders, even if for the cynical reason you're making, that person is probably very naive. Because if you know anything about people who are the movers and shakers in Ghana and what they can do behind the scenes, that is probably the worst tactical error anybody could have made in such a sensitive program. We'll come back to that. Let's bring Daniel K in. Danny K is here with tech and social media trends. He has a nice haircut. He has punk.
You have to qualify it.
Nathan, he has punk. So you tell us who is sponsoring his segment and then we'll move into the segment.
Well, yeah, the segment is brought to us by CalBank. CalBank is saying that if you reactivate your Cal account this season, you get more value, you get access to their short code service, *771#CalNet and the CalBank app. Talk to them via WhatsApp, social media, email, or you can call to free 0800-500-500. CalBank, forward together in the segment. It's also brought to us by Vodafone. Vodafone says with one Ghana CD, you get 20 minutes talk time to all networks and 1 GB of data every day between 5 a.m. and 11:59 a.m. Just dial *530# to subscribe and enjoy longer conversations and more browsing time. That's Vodafone, feather together.
Feather together. All right, you have a few minutes to tell us what's trending.
Liverpool is trending.
Quick. It's not true. Liverpool is not trending.
quick.
Yeah, let me do it fast.
Yes, quick.
Yes. The Bond was trending over there.
James Bond. Charlie, you have to apologize to Sir Tekpe. there was a time in Ghana, Sky was calling Sir Tekpe James Bond. Because every time they take me, they say Bond. Islam Bond. You were calling the take with James Bond.
Now see.
Write a letter and sign under your hand and apologize to me.
I'm sorry. City CBS is also trending. Yeah, it's a mixture of two things. A mixture of Goodbye My Lover. They say
he's not going forever.
Oh, no, they say they appreciate him. They say he did fantastically well. Yeah. And then, I'm back.
If he wasn't, my would have given him a girl. To cry his efforts.
I'm telling you. It depends on the terms of the marriage. You know, you can get an additional one.
In Jesus' name.
We will not go there.
I know we won't.
Ah, Sky, do you know Arsenal is trending?
Yeah.
Arsenal are the real deal.
Ten Hag is trending. Liverpool too was trending over the weekend.
No, but Liverpool and Chelsea are trending together. Why are you separating as well? Liverpool and Chelsea are trending. We have the same number of points. We are trending together.
But at least I'm the one doing this. I'm telling you that Liverpool is trending. Why are you trying to force Chelsea inside this one? Chelsea are not part. It's you.
They are rigging the trend.
Nepal is in the trend, so that's rather on a sad note. Yeah, there was a plane crash in Nepal. 68 people have been confirmed there. There were 72 people on board. It's very interesting videos that have come out. In fact, there was a passenger on board who was doing a live session when the plane crashed. So you can see exactly what happened inside
the plane.
The plane
is called the Yeti.
Named after the abominable snowman.
it's very sad. Tesla. Okay, Sky.
Yeah,
you were the one who was saying. He said I shouldn't tell anybody, but I'm telling people. He said he was planning to buy a Tesla. And I'm telling him that they've cut their prices. This year they've cut the prices. Yeah, 10%, 13% in UK, 20% in other parts. So
powerful.
Yeah. No, there's no excuse.
Does Ghana have a policy for electric car?
Well, you see, so that's one area that we seem to have so much gap. You know, we've been calling on them to do something about it, going green and investing. And then also that policy would also have to build the infrastructure necessary. Public ports that would be available for people to go and plug in and charge their vehicles.
It will help. It will help us a lot because our electricity production capacity is increasing. So if with fossil fuel and all the challenges they're facing, we should at least start thinking about electric Ubers.
Yeah, that's right. That
will help us.
A comprehensive policy that deals with these issues.
Is Madagascar trending?
No, Madagascar is not trending.
Black?
It was trending last night. It's left the trends this morning. But
Charlie, but what happened to Ghana?
What happened to Ghana?
Charlie, Madagascar.
We have to seriously look inside. But Bernard, when I came, you were talking about my haircut.
Your punk.
Yeah, it's nice,
I like it.
Yeah, there's a TV series. Yeah, in fact, they finished the first season.
Oh, you mean,
for those of you who missed it, the hairdressers.
You mean we are coming back?
We are coming back. But this one is on digital.
I need to see more.
So there's no missing it.
I need to see more men being made, their hair being done on the hairdressers.
What would they be doing about their hair?
Pay me. What time does it show?
10 a.m. on City TV.
I reject that.
Every day.
So on City TV. 10 a.m. on City TV, you see.
Live.
You know the concern that happens in hairdressers?
It's bad. Bad.
Since I've heard it.
Charlie. Look, they hold your feel out.
I know some men who drive their wife to the hairdresser and then sit there and wait. they don't want their wife to say anything.
But the problem is that when they leave, the hairdressers, they hold feel out for them. And the worst thing is when you appear on the television.
Ah, for one
Massa, make what make you go. You need to go to the bank first before we go and pay for the things. Time no day like that too.
Relax. Everything day my hand in.
controversial. The debt exchange was to have, the deadline for uptake was to have been today. I'm using the STEM words because I strongly suspect that there would be an extension. And I haven't received confirmation from government yet, but based on all we know, the uptake has not been positive. Mm-hmm. The inclusion of domestic, the inclusion of individual bondholders has rallied vocal support. You should have listened to Martin Kwebu and Senyu Hussi and Edu Ananiemchi surrounding a hapless, one of the spokespersons for the vice president this week on the big issue. They literally took him to the cleaners. In fact, when they gave Mr. Martin Kwebu the chance to talk, the person was like, no to DDE. No to DDE. And they all joined in. You know, it was really serious. So we are discussing this. I wanted Nathan to read a few quick comments.
Yep.
Then we'll see. Right. Two important tweets have come in, which reveal part of what Godfrey and Sky were saying. It's almost like a big divide in government.
Mm.
So,
okay. Yes. All right. Parkway Sin Tema says, Bernard, a natural mistake today will be the debt restructuring program and the haircut.
Yeah.
Another message, the hopes of members of the Ghana Insurance Association mm-hmm. of being excluded from the debt exchange will not materialize.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, this is because the finance ministry in a letter to the association signed by the minister says an exemption is not an option for the groups. Now, according to the association's president, Seth Aklasi, 40% of its total assets of Q3 2022 mm-hmm. were invested in GOG securities. Hence, any attempt mm-hmm. to give its members a haircut will worsen the situation.
Mm-hmm.
And however, the finance ministry is responding to the group and explained that based on feedback from industry players, it had made significant adjustments to the program mm-hmm. and will not exempt insurance. Okay.
All right.
Good morning, Bernard. The utterances and government posture from day one lacks consensus building. Mm-hmm. Even at this point that the government should be seen to take some actions to send a signal that could attract some public sympathy. They are still keeping the large government size and all of that.
All right, so a very significant shift in the conversation about the debt exchange was engineered when the nominee, a person that the majority leader in parliament, added his voice to views that including individual bondholders was inimical. Indeed, he goes to boldly say that it would wipe out the middle class. Now, we've managed to put him on the line to get his thoughts on this very serious issue on the day or the last day for uptake for the exchange. Honorable Chairman Sambosu's MP for Suami and Majority. Good morning, sir. Thanks for joining us.
Good morning, Bernard. And thank you for having me.
So, our analysis is that for a majority leader to add his voice to the advocacy against aspects of the debt exchange, it's very significant, and it was something you did not do lightly. So what's the background? Why did you decide to come out to speak against the inclusion of individual bondholders in the exchange?
My position is that if individual bondholders must be included, we need to have a greater dialogue on the matter. The people who came before us all recognize the fact that we are in difficult times as a nation. What ached some of them, or what ached them, was the fact that there was virtually no consultation. So they were kept in the dark. So my plea was that government should be much more engaging. We should recognize, as I said, that government, no government, of pleasure or displeasure in inflicting difficulties or hardship on the citizenry. We must also recognize that we are in difficult times and we need to all the turbulence together in order for us to be able to get ashore safely. So I'm aware that some kind of questions went on behind the curtain. But from what information that we had from the individual bondholders, they coming from the other side were saying that bluntly that they were not consulted. So it means that whatever consultation that might have gone on was not deep enough or broad enough. And that was at the pith of my plea that government should, all of us in government should be much more consultative. We should also recognize, I mean, as Ghanaians, and let's be pragmatic. And in these matters, the construction is also must be in play, because the longer the process delays, the greater the risk of people maybe pulling out investment through the window. You want to go through the front door to have these consultations and negotiations, and behind the curtains, people are pulling out their investment. So that is also another the flip side of it. So it's really a difficult process for all of us, notwithstanding acquiring strength. Nothing really can also take the place of consultation. What is significant about this is the fact that, as I indicated, the stakeholders, most of them, I would even venture to say that about 90-95% of them belong to the middle class. And if it should happen the way it's being done, it really may impose some difficulties on the middle class. Some of them nearing retirement age, depending on the use of these investments to pay for medication, to pay for school fees of kids, children, grandchildren, and so on and so forth. So it may really inflict some difficulties. So what is the best way about it? Some suggestions are being floated. For instance, government has come out to say that do not touch pension money. Some others are suggesting that, yes, even with the pension money, there are some of them who may not be falling on their pensions immediately. Maybe they may be falling on the pension 10, 12, 15 years from now. And those of them whose time may be due in the immediate future, 2, 3 years, 4, 5 years from now, you may not be able to touch their pension. But for those of them whose pension, the gestation period is longer from now, then perhaps we could find a way to also introduce them and avail some funding to government for stabilizing the shape of state. So these are matters that all of us will have a great option for.
Yeah, thanks for the explanation. But there's a view that with individual and household bondholders having just about 13% of government debt, and as you rightly pointed out, they being middle class people, these are people who can fight for themselves, and that the larger group of poor people who are part of, as you said, pensions, collective investment schemes, and mutual funds, because they don't have enough money to individually go and get their own bonds, they are the ones who ought to be getting the attention of the majority leader or people who are against the in aspect of the deal. And how come it's rather this small group of 13% of government debt that has attracted your attention? Because individual bondholders are generally, as you said, middle class people. They can do their own class action lawsuits. So it's rather the poor farmer, the teacher, those who are collectively part of schemes that don't have a voice that ought to have attracted your intervention, not this group.
This group proposed that approached us. I'm not really sure by what you are saying that we should have waved them aside and told them that, oh, out there, we have a larger group, so we're with you. I'm not really sure that is the response that you wanted from us. But they are the people who came before us. And I'm just saying, if you listen to me, I said that I'm talking about when we engage them. I said that this whole business, I think we should reflect. That is about the debt exchange and see the best approach to adopt. The Honorable Atto Fawcett brought the experiences that Jamaica and Greece bring to bear. So I was really relating to the generality of it, that this whole exercise, maybe we should be a bit more reflective on it to determine for ourselves the best way forward. So it was an all-inclusive matter that I raised, even though the individual bondholders were the ones who approached us last Friday.
Fair enough. Is there a concern that the decision to include the individual bondholders could be an attempt by some people managing the process to emasculate or to reduce the influence of some individual board holders who are considered politically powerful. I mean, my colleague Richard Sky was making the point that some of them feel that it was a cynical decision to include them because the president was very clear in his announcement to us a month back that they would not be included. So some people feel that it was a belated attempt to get at specific individuals because, of course, the person managing the process would know who has which bond and what the person's value is. Did your group consider that in your as you listened to them?
I don't know of the cynicism that government is supposedly introducing to this. When you say to me that some are saying that is a cynical attempt to include otherwise powerful individuals. Look, there are some members of parliament who are deeply in this. But we are not raising the matter as members of parliament. Right? So it's cross-cutting. And I'll respectfully implore you to let us cut out politics from this. It is about lives. It is about livelihood. So let's look at it that way, rather than introducing unnecessary politicization of this matter. It will not be helpful. Let's look at it with clear eyes, with a clear conscience, and cut out the politics.
But to the extent that the domestic debt exchange is almost a prerequisite for the IMF deal, and looking at the fact that today being the 16th, we are not sure if we've even crossed the 40%, not even 50% threshold. Government has not told us. Doesn't your intervention jeopardize the whole process? Because I know your intervention was very clear about the individual bondholders, but there's a view that the thing is not gaining traction, and bringing the individual bondholders in was an attempt to increase the percentage that government would get so they can then get the bond approval. So by a significant person like you coming in to say no, don't include these guys, is there not a risk of jeopardizing the whole IMF process, which is really the objective, at least if the Minister of Finance is to be believed, of this process?
I'm not too sure that you really listen to me, because you are bold in your declaration that I said that we should not include individual bondholders. It was not the pivotal consideration or submission that I made. What I said was that if they have to be included, let's pause and reflect and engage.
Okay, I think that's an important distinction. Maybe I misheard you. Thank you. So you are saying that if they'll be included, then we must engage again to look at the implications and not just move as if the business as usual.
That's exactly what I said. Because as I said from the very outset, we're in a democracy, and what concerns all of us should be decided on by all of us. Let's get the buy-in of the people. That was at the center of it. I was not emphatic in saying that. Let's not include them.
Okay.
That was not.
Thank you for the clarification.
It's much more engaging.
Yes. But if I interpret that to still mean a spanner in the works, that would not be too wrong, because the deadline is today. The people came to you on Friday. Today is the next working day. So obviously...
Which is what issue that I even spoke about when we met, that it's about late. I mean, maybe this thing ought to have come, attention ought to have been brought to this much earlier. Notwithstanding, better late than never. If there is any window of opportunity that could be explored, why not?
Okay. And again, pardon me for the initial misinterpretation. I probably got carried away because your chief whip also made similar comments, and indeed he tweeted at us. So if I am permitted to read, Honorable Frank Anodonpre from his verified account tweeted on the 14th that the finance minister stroke ministry must, at a matter of urgency, review ASAP its decision and resolution on individual bondholders. I don't agree with them, and I think it's unfair and untenable. Review your decision now, with an exclamation mark, And then he tweets at Joy FM and City FM. So maybe we sort of included all of that. Is Anodon Prayer on his own? I know you've explained what you are saying, but you are the majority leader. He's the majority whip. So if the media assumes that the leadership of MPP in parliament is not happy with the inclusion of individual bondholders, we cannot be faulted too much.
I guess you can speak to him, the chief whip, and then, not knowing the background and the backdrop of his own contestation, I wouldn't want to jump onto it. But he is the, like you're speaking with me, you speak to the issue that I raised when we met. We met, we had indicated to come to me, and I got the soundbite that they had also informed the minority leader. So when they came to me, the minority leader had asked the Honorable Amar Kofi Bua to represent him, later joined by the ranking person for finance. But then there was a whole train of the minority group with it. Even though it was the leadership of parliament they were coming to see, it ended up that about 10 or so of the minority group followed them into my office. So they came to me as the majority leader. And the my colleague, the minority leader, also flanked me. But he happened to be in Somali at the time, which was why at least the two of them had to join me. But others also joined. But I spoke to the leader at the time of the House, because the invitation to us was that Parliament was to assist them in addressing this matter. And I said, at the time, I'll ferry it. Unfortunately, the figure is not even in the system.
Mm.
I said, I'll ferry it to the minister and the executive. Incidentally, the petition itself was addressed to the Minister of Finance and not even to Parliament. So so I thought that perhaps they might have deposited a copy or the prime document with the Minister of Finance. Be that as it may, as I said, when I spoke for myself and for Parliament and assured them that upon reconvening, which is going to be this January 31st, we certainly would take the matter up to see what the steps that we could take for to assist the system. So that's what I said to them.
Mm.
As for Allah and what you are telling me, I'm not ready.
But I will speak to him. But I just ask that if your chief whip is tweeting about such an important topic in such definitive terms, and obviously you are not aware that he put this tweet out, that is still a problem, right? Because if I'm a majority leader and my chief whip, who's supposed to really take a cue from me on some of these matters, is already in public blatantly opposing such an important government policy, it's a challenge, is it not? I mean, some would even say that could point to some lack of discipline within the front bench of the majority.
I don't want to go into that. What I know is that my chief whip, I think he called out together with the speaker for some conference that held in the Emirates. I don't even know whether he's back or not. But this is a very topical matter that maybe upon reflection he decides to put out something that I've not really read, and I don't also know the content. And also the background of the world, not knowing that, I wouldn't want.
Fair enough. I have two final questions for you, sir. Thank you for your forbearance. First one is, was Parliament consulted at all about the DDE before it was announced?
In the lead up to the presentation of the budget, which is what the minister. I brought the minister to have some conversation about the direction that the budget was going to take. That had not even happened before in the life of parliament that I have been in since 1997. It was an innovation that I was trying to engender, occasioned by, especially where we are, the current state of business. And I thought that from now on, the Minister of Finance will have to sit with Parliament and brief us about the broad contours of the anticipated budget, so that if there are any matters that we consider, Parliament considers critical, Parliament then would open up to the Minister allow him the opportunity to talk to those matters and possibly to include them if they are not already in the budget. So we had this maiden meeting at Euphoria before the budget came to be consummated and then later on presented on behalf of the president. There were broad discussions. The details were not known to us at the time, but some consultations went on as to where exactly we are as a nation. I'm not too sure that this matter came up for discussion. Maybe the broad strokes were mentioned, but not the details as we are getting to know now, honestly.
All right. And finally, there is a view that even in government, there are a lot of significant people in government in the EMT who disagree with the approach of the Ministry of Finance in the DDE. Is this something you can confirm?
First of all, I'm not in the EMT. And second, as cabinet, we swear oaths of secrecy. You don't expect me to divulge whatever happens in cabinet to us.
No, not the individual positions. Just that, for example, is cabinet in concert in support of this?
I'm saying to you that in cabinet, we swear oaths of secrecy. So we don't throw in any bait.
Oh, no, but we know that the oath of secrecy means that but cabinet also communicates decisions. So even though there's an oath of secrecy,
absolutely.
That is on the basis of... Yeah, so what I'm saying that...
From what cabinet, the official position is. Beyond that, I don't speak as an individual or happening in cabinet. With respect.
All right. Thank you for talking to us. That was Honorable Chairman Sambusu, MP for Suyame, explaining the concern. I think I need to clarify that. So initially, because of the Anodom Bird tweet and the way we read his comment, I sort of went out to say he opposes. But he's basically saying Senyo's group and Edu Anani and all the other, they came to him and the leadership of parliament, and they came to say, look, this is going to be inimical to us. And they say government should pause and talk to the people and include their views before they proceed. Mm-hmm. It's not the same as saying he blatantly opposes it, which is why I brought Anodom Bird point in. Anodom Bird is basically saying it's not right. And I needed to point out that, and Sky, you can confirm this for me. I mean, the leader of our parliament, a majority leader and his chief whip must sing from the same hymn sheet. There's no law that says they can't have individual views on a matter. But for something as sensitive for the government like this, for the chief whip to be so clear, reveal your decision now with an exclamation mark, he's literally shouting. So I'm sure I can be pardoned for... Okay, is Mr. Chairman supposed to sort of being over technical here, where he says he did not say he's opposing the thing, but he's saying that they should consult the people?
Well, I think you know him better than I do,
so help me here, because me,
I think he's being nuanced, because I mean, he occupies a very sensitive position, and trying to be diplomatic about the whole thing, that if you have to engage properly.
He's speaking in code. he's coding the language.
Exactly.
Uh-huh. Which is what people of that level are supposed to do. But sometimes candor is also critical.
Yeah.
But I think you are right. He has to be measured because it could misinterpret it. Let's bring you two things. From now till 31st March 2023, insure your vehicle with Imperial General Assurance and win handsome rewards. Yes, it's instant. Just insure, pick your rewards, fuel coupons, gift vouchers, special souvenirs, and more. And here's the big deal. Imperial is also giving you a free one-year life insurance cover as part of your motor insurance cover. So get it double from Imperial General. Call us today, 0302-788-955. That's 0302-788-955. Or talk to any of our agents across the country for further details. Imperial General Assurance, solid protection. We've been talking about your money all morning. So it's time for your money.
Mm-hmm.
The segment is brought to you by CBG. We stand with you. Who will be bold enough to take it up today?
I'm taking it up today. And the money tip is from Timothy Ferris, who says, and since we are talking about what investment firms and whatnot are doing with our money, he says, money is multiplied in practical value depending on the number of W's you control in your life.
Mm. Hey.
What you do.
Oh, I thought you were going to say water.
Let me finish.
Women.
Yeah.
So you go.
Yeah. So what you do, when you do it, where you do it, and with whom you do it.
What you do, when you do, where and with whom.
Yes.
That controls what?
That is how your money is multiplied in practical value.
Yeah.
So depending on the number of W's you control. So if you control what you do, when you do it, where you do it and with whom you do it, you are practically helping to multiply. But there's some other one bit that fascinates me in some corner. Some Ashanti proverb about money. Charlie, I did not know this one.
What's he saying?
Charlie, Aloski. He said, it is not that dogs prefer bones to meat. It is that no one gives them meat.
So we shouldn't assume that because dogs like bone. Dogs chew because they like bone. It's because oh, you know,
I'm
not
don't
tell me, don't be. But it's also a proverb that it is a wise person who bites into a bone and give him an egg or something like that.
See, the dog matter, no? I think it's contextual. Because elsewhere, in the other world, they actually give meat, proper meat, to the dogs.
Yes.
But in our context, you know, the meat some no day. So that be why they give them the bones. Do you understand what I mean?
But you know, bones.
Majority of the time.
Bones and dogs are an association.
Well, that's true.
So it's not a Ghanaian
thing. It's universal.
Yeah, but
bones and dogs.
Then we have to examine. We have to examine the Ashanti
problem. A bank that supports you. A bank that cares.
Day of our third week of Effective Living series. Taka Awori is my guest. We're talking about self-leadership in the new world of work. It's part of our professional priority focus for week 3 Effective Living series, brought to you by Hallmark Logistics and Enterprise Insurance. But here's a question. Is your world still home when others are in school? Enroll today at the Morningstar International High School for your cherished secondary education in the Cambridge or the WASI program. Our award-winning school has international accreditation as well as conducive academic and boarding facilities. Admission is scheduled for January 2023. Join the Morningstar International High School, an institution with a tradition of excellence. Call 0303-975-628 or 0243-758-795. Morningstar, arise and shine. And hooray, Provident Insurance is 40. Provident Insurance welcomes you to a new year. Remember to insure your new car or renew your existing motor insurance policy from now till 31st of March and get free gifts such as fuel coupons and several other branded Provident souvenirs. Rush now for insurance cover now. Terms and conditions apply. And remember, with Provident, man, you are covered. And Heritage Christian College, located at Amasaman and behind the Olympic Stadium, is affiliated to KNUST and accredited by GTEC. Programs include BBA program in accounting, marketing, HR, management, banking and finance, business information, technology management, and more. We also do Bachelor of Theology, BSc Information Technology, and we do tutorials for the professional courses. Entry requirements are WASI, ABCE, or GBCE, or HND. We also have mature students' admissions. Call 054 0207-777-731 or 0202-298-399 or go online to hcuc.edu.gh for more information.
All right, more messages. Tony, very interesting message. He says, I'm happy we, the middle class, have finally received our reward. We kept mute over the mismanagement, thinking we would never be affected because we had managed to provide for ourselves where government had failed. On health, we go to private hospital. On education, we take our kids to private school. State institutions for service, we bribe to get our service in time. Now it is the turn of the middle class. That's from Tony. This one says, I invested in Ecobank EDC almost a year ago for long-term investment. As it stands, I don't know where I belong. Can you also bring the people from Ecobank to your studio to give us some education? The last update I got from Ecobank shows that I will lose 29K out of my 110,000 if I should go for my money today. So it looks like the mark to market.
It's marking and marketing.
Kofi from Amasaman says, this government always assumes they can push things down the throats of Ghanaians without resistance.
Mm.
They have never been democratic in anything they do, right from Ejapa to E-Levy, etc. This time around, they are going to fail because personnel of key institutions like the judiciary and legislature are going to be greatly affected. Clearly, everyone seems to be moving away from supporting the finance minister, except his appointer. Right? This one says, I'm beginning to realize how most of this current government appointees keep sounding like they were not part of this government's administration when policies were being pushed through and they didn't have a say.
Hmm.
It says NATO government inquiry. From OEB Center.
No action, talk only.
Tell you.
This is Alankash.
Bernard, fuel prices are to be increased by 5% for petrol and 9% for diesel today. Like how? Are we serious in this country? The dollar is rising again. Euro is more expensive than the dollar now. Those who mismanage the economy are still in charge.
Now, I wanted to bring something, then we'll tie everything together. So, listening to the Big Issue over the weekend, one of the things that came up was Martin Kpebo and Co. were saying, look, government has money. So they should not think that their domestic debt exchange is the only way they can save money. Mm-hmm. And as you guys have been saying on the show, they were given many ways in government could cut cost. Trouble though is that the government could be forced to present to us this choice of more infrastructure projects, debt exchange. No debt exchange, we don't have money for infrastructure development. And already the road contractors are complaining about a debt that's close to 6 billion cedis that they are owed, which they say is emasculating them. Here is the chairman of the association speaking to Caleb Kuda.
We've caught up with the national chairman of the Association of Road Contractors Ghana. His name is John Afo Jr. Want to find out from him if the contractors who belong to his association have seen any disbursement so far and whether or not they are satisfied with the development. Sir, good to have you. So the sector minister gave assurances that a chunk of monies owed Ghanaian contractors will be paid by the end of December. Have you seen any such disbursements and are you satisfied?
Thank you very much, Caleb. This question is very important and dear to our hearts. That is the members of the Association of Road Contractors Ghana. And this information we received from the press that the monies owed us by the government is going to be paid by the end of the year was welcoming to us. We were all happy that it was going to happen. So then immediately, the National Executive met and decided to go around and see its effect, what is happening in all the various agencies, the various places where road projects are being done. We went to Cocoa Board, and what we found out was some payment was done, but to the extent that it was very disheartening, payments of 10 to 16% of what was owed contractors was being paid. That is, there were payments that had delayed for 2-3 years, some 4-5 years, but they were paid only 10%, 14% of the amount. And it was not acceptable by our members, and it was making us suffer. If this announcement had not gone on, we knew very well that we're being owed, but there was no money to pay us. But if you announce to the whole world that you are paying contractors by the end of the year, and our suppliers, our creditors, our banks are chasing us to bring the money into our accounts, what do we do? Caleb, it has really had a tail on us to the extent that the contractors are even running away from their homes. They can't stay because they are being chased in the morning, afternoon, and evening. There are calls to the national executive, the leaders, what we are doing about it. But what can we do than to plead that this call to us wasn't necessary at all? What crime have we caused? Have we committed any crime in Ghana that to the extent that if you decide to be a road contractor, go for the work, do the work, and be told that there is no money to pay you for now? The minister ahead said they will be gradual, making payment gradually. At least it is good. But how soon is the gradual? How soon is the payment going to be made? If I mention some figures to you, Caleb, you'll be surprised. If shocked, the Ghana Road Fund owes contractors 5.9 billion as at the end of October 2022. 5.9 billion Ghana cedis as at the end of October 2022. It was surprised for you to know that only about 54 million of the amount was paid in December. Even look at the percentage. I mean, it is nothing to write home about. It is nothing to tell anybody that we are paying contractors. Those who received it, some of them have reported that they didn't even see the money in the account because the bank just took it. Just took the money. When you get to GAG, I went around and chanced on a list of contractors who are being owed and being paid. Imagine somebody being owed 54 million and he's being paid 6 million. 50 million being paid 6 million. This person was very lucky. He's owed 49 million and he's having 20 million. 30 million, 6 million. 26 million, he's lucky 10 million. 28 million, 6 million. 24 million, 5 million. These are releases to be done by the Ministry of Finance, where Ghana's money is controlled. And people, contractors are being owed these huge sums of money, and you are releasing these monies, and you say we are paying contractors. It's unbelievable.
But you do appreciate that we are in difficult times, and the president has called on all Ghanaians to bear with the government as it tries to, you know, sort everyone out. So as the road minister said, it will be done gradually, but then he also said a chunk of it will be done. So that's where your concern is, and also the fact that the announcement has made all your creditors and people who depend on you now come demanding. Is that not it?
Yes. If this announcement had not been done, we are all quiet. Our creditors are quiet, suppliers are quiet, but because of this they are all chasing us. So that is where we see. You see, when teachers are paid monthly, is it announced? No. When nurses are paid, is it announced? No. Lecturers, they go on strike. Teachers go on strike. Nurses go on strike. Is it announced? No. But in our case, anytime we are being paid, that means it is news. It is news. And that thing must stop somewhere. It is not only this government, I must say. I must be very frank. Successive governments have been doing this. But and it has reached this end, 5.9 billion in one fund. Do you know the inflow at the road fund? I hear it is just about 1.2 billion a year. There is capping on the road fund. So it means government takes a chunk of it. Then after that, what is left at the road fund itself? There is a loan taken by the road fund from some banks. So every month, they have to take some of their money and pay those loans. So what is left is just a little. an average of about 30, 40 million a month. And Caleb, would you imagine that if you have 5.9 billion arrears to pay, and you have, your inflow for the month is 40 million, how many months is it going to take you to clear the debt? It means it is never going to happen.
That was the chairman of the Road Contracts Association. Let's listen to the PR for the ministry, Nasir Ahmed Yate, Nathan's friend. he attempted to respond to the comments that were made by the road contractors about they not having been paid.
Responding to the concerns of the contractors is the PRO of the Ministry of Roads and Highways. His name is Ahmad Nasir Yate. Sir, the minister assured these contractors that a chunk of the debts owed them will be paid. They say you pay them peanuts and now their creditors are chasing them.
Well, it's good you are alluding to the fact that some payment has been made. As the minister said, before the Xmas break. And so the assurance I can give is that, yes, government owe the contractors. The contractors are very key stakeholders in this whole business of trying to provide portable, good road to the good people of Ghana. The assurance is that for every quarter, the ministry receives releases from the road fund. And so as and when we receive some releases, payment will be made. Government is committed to pay road contractors for the job, the yeoman's job they've done for this nation. And so effort will continue to make the effort to ensure that they receive their payments.
They say that you owe them in excess of 5 billion. And you're saying that you'll be paying them on the next quarterly basis when you get some funds from the road fund. How reassuring can this be for the contractors, some of whom owe a lot? And they say that even when the money hits their accounts, the banks just took it because then they owe so much. And some of their employees, they are not able to keep their businesses afloat. And some of their businesses are actually collapsing.
Well, government is very committed to make sure that contractors receive their payment. That is what I can say on record. And we are in constant touch with the contractors. My minister especially is in contact and constant engagement with them. And so all the effort being made, they are aware of it.
Yo, Ahmed, we've heard. Your minister is in constant touch. Kale, where did you get? Is the contractor calling? Say, hey.
Yeah, they are very upset.
They are broke.
They are not happy at all. And the broke point you made
reminds
me.
6 billion cedis.
Yes, 5.9 billion cedis.
Over which period?
He didn't tell me, but they had put this together over some time, and it's particularly is in response to the roads minister saying they're going to pay a chunk of the debts owed them by the end of December. And they're saying when they put together all that their members have received, it's not significant. And also, they are very concerned that SNIT and then GRA do not consider the fact that when they show them the debt government owes them, they do not give them credit. They say that they should go borrow money to either file their workers' SNITs or to pay their taxes.
I heard that this morning. So they're saying, if I have an employee and I've not filed,
exactly,
even though government owes me, I don't have any money,
exactly,
they still would prosecute you for non-payment.
Exactly.
Well, it's a complicated situation. I have this sense, guys, that the government may be using the lack of money and the fact that they haven't paid contracts to say that, look, we are in a difficult time. If we don't go for debt exchange, there's going to be more of these things.
Look, I think everybody around understands and recognizes that we are in a difficult place. I don't think the government will have to remind all of us, you know. And of course, the contractors. And I'm happy that the contractors are now speaking because usually when these things happen, you want them to say something initially, they don't. But over time, they are a bit more vocal. And I'm happy that they are vocal. I'm happy that even if you look at the domestic debt exchange program, you find a lot more people willing to speak out and all, and you know, which is good. I wonder how, and look, maybe I'm asking a very dumb question, pardon my words, but how is it that constantly we seem to have this issue? Look, government has been owing contractors since what, 20?
Eche. It's very long.
It's been a long time, and we've seen...
Yeah, but I think the logic of the argument is that the government has the responsibility of providing social services.
Of course.
And infrastructure. So the government says, we don't have liquidity, we don't have money. So if people don't sacrifice individually by taking part in the debt exchange, the money in the pool to do the things that we all need will suffer. So they are presenting us a choice of saying, you know what, either you come onto this debt exchange thing, so you take a haircut here, he takes a shave there, then we, as the argument is an efficient allocator of resources, we provide a road for you to then do business and make more money, or provide educational facility or provide security. But the other question is government doing justice to the amount of money we give it?
That's the fact that
individuals want to leave. Because, look, there's an article I read recently where people have used private means to solve public problems. So you pay high school fees in a private school, you come together and try and do your own gutters. But the government says, I'm a more efficient allocator of resources. So when we are in difficult times, you sacrifice and give me the money, and I'll use it to do something that we all will benefit. I think the Ghanaian citizens need to ask themselves, is the money better in our individual pockets, or is it better in government pockets? I think that's the question we're facing economically. I don't have the answer. Sky, I don't know if you have the answer.
Well, I mean, government will always control public resources. The reason is that ultimately private sector can't do it. So that's why we have outsourced our responsibilities, our desires, aspirations. We've given it to a government, and we believe that government will serve our very best interests. It is just unfortunate that in our part of the world, majority of the time, governments fail to discharge their responsibilities to the citizenry, because there's a social contract that, look, I'll give you the authority that ordinarily I should wield over my household, what I buy, what I don't buy, how I invest, how I don't invest. Mm. And I'm giving that to you, you the government, and you should discharge those responsibilities for and on my behalf to serve my interests. But what are we seeing? The rules are not built. Even if they are built, they are built poorly. You know, government sector, you know, investments that have been made, people have been told over the years that, look, put the money into government, bonds. We would serve your interest. We would make sure that when the maturity comes, we'll pay you your interest. And when you want to take out your principal, we'll give all of that to you. What are we hearing now? Government had mismanaged the system so much so that we are now even forced to now speak up. Now, the question is, at what point does government have legitimacy to go back to the people and say that, look, we at this point, we cannot turn to anybody else. Let's now rely on your savings. I believe that there should be a legal test to that.
Yeah.
Because we've seen how this government and previous governments behaved with our resources. And even in the midst of the crisis we face, there are presidential trips that are still happening across the country. Of course, they come at a cost. The question is, are those trips necessary? There are ministerial trips that are still happening. There are chief executives who are still out of the country. There are ordinary, you know, people in government offices who are still out of the country.
I've asked you to do the numbers, and I'll challenge you to do it before the end of the month for me, where you can show me places where government can cut expenditure to ease the self-imposed pressure. Because you've made this point a lot of times, and I feel adding a bit of, for example, we know there are over 800 or number of presidential staffers or whatever in the under the rubric of Office of the President. If we can do some back of the envelope analysis of how much it actually costs to run this government, we'll be in a very good position to make a case for what you're saying. The other thing I wanted to say though was that Nathan, if you read Gabby's tweets, he's basically saying if the debt exchange fails, even your bond that's there that you are not going to sign up for the debt exchange will be much, much worse. So it's almost saying you have no choice but to do it. But the question is that really the case? Because if you think about it, even if the debt exchange does not go through, aren't there other ways the government could have dealt with this situation?
Well, you see, Bernard, that's where I respond to the question by saying that, look, the IMF did not say go and do, you know, debt exchange program. The government said, the IMF says, go and cut expenditure. How you go and do it is your matter. The government looks around the world and says that, okay, one of the models that, you know, countries have used is the sovereign debt restructuring program. Some people had to compel their citizens to go for the exchange program because they thought that it was easy to use the law for that, to achieve that effect. Greece, for instance, did that. Our situation is different because our constitution says in Article 20 that you cannot go for somebody's property, confiscate it to the state without having to pay what you call a prompt compensation for the same. So the Attorney General came out clearly to say that you cannot do this.
Mm.
So now you have to, you have a Fukukuna mobile, please bring your money. And we'll use that to solve the problem. And when we solve the problem, you are better off. The difficulty, however, is that the government's own attitude and language and posturing hasn't changed. You understand? We want a leaner government. It's not happening. We want you to be more prudent with the use of the resources. Yeah. It's not happening.
And Sky, don't forget when we interviewed Chairman, sir, when I asked him whether Parliament was consulted, you know he was very diplomatic.
Yeah.
But the import of his answer was that beyond the courtesy of just informing them, they didn't have the details.
Yeah.
Because I'm sure that Parliament could have even come up with a way of saying, okay, debt exchange will kill confidence in our investment sector. So you could say, let's put in a temporary tax of your profit. So let me give an example. I have given money to EDC or Data Bank. I'm expecting 60,000 CDs as my increase in whatever. You could say, we will pay that by impose a 10% tax on it. Right. So for the next 5 years, any profit you make in your investment will tax it. That could be more acceptable than to say, I'm going to default and I'm the promise I made to you as government. Because for me, as we've said, the idea of mobilizing resources from people who have excess of it into the financial sector is based on trust. As soon as you break that trust, the whole thing collapses. Because there will never be enough money to pay everybody when they want their money at the same time. And I don't know who... That's why Godfrey's point about that committee's work is so critical. And I think the committee should publish that report, if not for anything at all, for the sake of posterity, for us to know
what they told the government.
Because if you have industry people, the last thing they would want is a default. Because when the 2018 financial crisis happened, they moved a lot of money into government bonds because they said they were the safest.
Yes.
4 years later, you are saying you can't pay and you are giving me 12 bonds spread over 15 years. You are basically telling me that if I have money, I should put it under my bed, I should go and buy a land somewhere, or I should go and buy US currency. I should not give it to government. So if there was an alternative, and I strongly feel that you could have introduced a temporary tax on certain kinds of profits, which will still guarantee the government paying. So front-loading government's revenue by doing this debt exchange is very unpopular, a complete miscalculation, and it's probably not going to work. I don't know whether the finance ministry is listening to Chairman and Co. this week. I'll be very surprised if they don't make a big announcement about the debt exchange by close of tomorrow.
Like close of day, actually.
Oh, today. Oh, fine.
The thing expires today. And if you don't make an announcement, I mean, we don't know where we'll be going from here. But it's also important to know two key institutions, Cabinet and the Council of State. You know, these things, when big decisions, you know, the Council of State has a committee responsible for the economy.
Yes.
And Togi Afede at some point was exactly. Yeah. The question is, a major government decision like this, they must have done something on it. Have we heard them say anything about this particular matter? And was there a wise counsel to government as to how they should approach it? Where's that report? Is it possible to tell us they serve our interests?
Right.
They are more or less the upper chamber of parliament, de facto.
Yes.
And then the cabinet. The last time I was listening to Kwame Pienim, he was suggesting that it would seem that cabinet did not even sit to discuss this matter.
I will not be surprised.
Of course, there's no compulsion that necessarily the president has to consult cabinet on every decision. The constitution doesn't provide that. Instead, cabinet helps the president to discharge his mandate. But the question is, a matter like this, two heads are better than one, right? So there ought to have been some engagement. If there was some engagement at cabinet level, where's that report? Can we see it?
These questions will remain as we continue the program. We'll take a breather from all the economics and come to the Effective Living series, which will help you detox because there are a lot of giddy discussions about money and things, and I'm sure you're getting overwhelmed. So this week, we're focusing on your professional priorities for the year 2023. My guest is Taka Awori, and we're speaking about self-leadership in the new world of work. It's brought to you by Hallmark Freight and Logistics Ghana and Enterprise Insurance.
This is the City Breakfast Show, the city's biggest conversation.
Freight forwarding just got easier. Say goodbye to the days of excuses and disappointments with Hallmark Freight and Logistics Ghana Limited. Our attention to detail prevents customers from ever having to pay demurrage. Our quality and cost-effective services include ocean freight, air freight, customs clearance, logistics, warehousing, project cargo, ex-works, haulage, break bulk, and courier services. Trust us to get your goods from any part of the world delivered to you at your convenience. Have your air freight delivered in less than 24 hours, sea freight in less than 48 hours, and land freight in just 4 hours. Visit our offices on the 4th floor of Allied Heights, Abelempe, or Cargo Village Airport. Call us today on 0302-915-335 or 0501-471-599 or visit our website hallmarkfreightgh.org. Hallmark Freight and Logistics, your trusted and reliable partner.
OneXBet. Easy betting, easy winnings. OneXBet, the most reliable service to make deposits easily with high odds and numerous bonuses on the spot. Register now at onexbet.com.gh. Use promo code BESTODDSGH to get 300% bonus up to 3,445 Ghana cedis on your first deposit. Easy to use, easy to have a chance to win. OneXBet, reliable bookmaker. Gambling can be addictive. Bet responsibly. Not for person under 18 years. This advertisement has been vetted and approved by the Gaming Commission.
Get ready for a world of learning and career opportunities in a safe and welcoming environment. Australia, it's time to discover your brilliant future self. Best Education Services, in partnership with top-tier Australian universities, invites you to the best education.
On the theme 2023 Starter Pack, this series is focused on helping you start the year well and end strong. We're focusing in this third week on what we call professional priorities. So we'll be talking about things through your professional development as a leader and as a person. My guest is no stranger to the series. She is the founder and lead, I believe, for Busara Africa.
That's right.
Takawori, always great to have you. How are you doing?
I'm well. Happy New Year.
Many, many happy returns. I mean, Happy New Year to you as well.
Yes.
So we're talking about leading self in the new world of work. That's our topic for the series for this morning. And Taka will be, as ever, taking us through the slides. I think this leading self concept I first heard from you. I'm not sure if I, because for some time we were talking about leadership, and you sort of brought up this idea about leading self.
Yes.
So maybe you should patent it.
I should, but others have used it. But it's something, you know, what you've probably heard me say is,
yes,
you can't lead another until you lead yourself.
I believe
so
I've heard
it always that. Starts with leading.
Mm. But we're talking about the new world of work.
Yes.
So let's start from there. What is the new world of work and what should we expect this year?
And yes. So a couple of things. The first thing is not the good news. And I have been listening to you all for the past couple of weeks and everything that's happening in Ghana.
Hmm.
One can expect that the new world of work, not just in Ghana, but elsewhere, means continued uncertainty and job insecurity.
Okay.
As we talk about a global recession and the kind of economic turmoil we're seeing here in Ghana. So that's one thing, uncertainty and job insecurity. The second thing we're seeing as a result of that job insecurity is increased stress and mental health challenges associated with this type of insecurity. So that's another facet of this new world of work. But what we're also seeing as continuation from the time of COVID is continued use of remote working and increasingly hybrid working. So it's not totally going away, but you're finding increasingly companies at one point, they will be all remote, then they'll do a hybrid. You see what happened to DataBank recently where they're like, all of a sudden we'll do remote working. Sometimes you have some folks doing a combination of the two. So that's going to be a continued factor.
So when customers are angry.
Ah, so you see that flexibility. Better work from home where you can ensure security. Yeah. The other thing you're seeing in this new world of work is an increased use of geographically dispersed workers. So not having everybody sitting in a team in Accra. You might have some in Kumasi, or increasingly what I'm seeing is you might have a team in Accra and another team in Johannesburg and another team in Nairobi. And later I'm going to talk about the opportunities in that. It's geographically dispersed workers. Which means that the new world of work is also about distributed teams working remotely. So your team of people may not all be sitting in the same location with you. We're also seeing, and what you can expect in 2023, is continued use of digitized operations or digitalized operations in the world of work, where because, again, of the tough economic times, you are seeing many companies are seeking to become more efficient. Cutting costs, so really taking as many things as they come on, as many things as they can online. Because of what's happening, and I think again because of the economic crunches in so many markets, you're finding that many companies are again going to need to think of new business models, think more creatively. So the new world of work is also a place where there's a premium put on creativity, agility, adaptation, innovation. Those were words that really came out in 2020. You're going to continue hearing them in the world of work. We will also see an elimination and possibly redesign of workplaces. So increasingly, again, in the spirit of cutting costs, managing costs, many companies are going to be thinking, if we're doing a form of hybrid working, do we need this entire space with all these offices? Can we be a little bit more creative? Can we do some co-shared space working? Those kinds of things. But now the last thing you will see is creation of more work opportunities than employment opportunities. And again, I will speak to that a little bit later in terms of what I mean. So in summary, Bernard, the new world of work that we can expect is one of two things. It's one of turbulence, let's not lie. It's one of turbulence, but it's also one of opportunity.
That's very interesting. It seems a lot of negatives, but you still found a way to to put opportunity there. I was going to ask, this doesn't seem too good news. It looks
overall, I would say that the new world of work is going to be a tough place to operate in. But if you're strategic, it can also be a space of opportunities. And I'm hoping the principles I share can be one that can enable people to not just survive, but also potentially thrive.
All right, let's talk about the principles then. You said if you can adopt those principles, then you would survive and thrive as well. So tell me what I need to do in this not so pleasant reality that you're painting.
Yes. So how do you lead self? Those are three principles I'd love to share.
Okay.
The first is around getting grounded. Now, the getting grounded is what, as I said, really enables you to stabilize yourself during turbulence.
Okay.
The second is, I say, get connected. Now that's where you're starting to reposition yourself mm-hmm. to take opportunity of the, to take advantage of the opportunities. And the third is to be future ready. That's also an ability to take advantage of the opportunities. So those are the three principles, and mm-hmm. I would love to go through
so
each.
So get grounded downwards,
get connected, and be future ready.
I like the directional dimension. Yes. So let's get into grounding yourself.
Okay.
How do you do that?
So this principle of getting grounded is about being resilient. Okay. I mean, we've talked about resilience for the past couple of years, and mm-hmm. it's going to continue to be a key factor in this new world of work that is increasingly insecure. And here are some tips in terms of how do you get grounded. The first is what I call bring out your anchors.
Mm.
Now imagine the metaphor of a ship mm-hmm. or a boat, and you're in turbulent waters, which for many of us, the workplace will be. Yeah? You put out your anchors. Your anchors are what stabilize you as a person during crisis.
Mm.
Now, for some people, it might be their faith.
Mm.
For others, it might be family.
Mm-hmm.
For others, it might be a support network.
Mm.
The point here is each person needs to understand what stabilizes you during crisis. And that's what you need to prioritize now. That's your anchor. Mm-hmm. Bring it out, focus on it, prioritize it.
I like that.
So first step, bring out your anchor.
Mm.
The second is plug, I love the boat metaphor, plug
the
leak in your boats.
Okay.
Again, imagine stormy waters here. What we find is during periods of stress, uncertainty and anxiety, unfortunately, not the best of us shows up. So sometimes, in other words, we're not at our best often when we're really under the crunch. And I've seen it in many workplaces where people are feeling insecure about their jobs. They might be restructuring. What starts to happen is you might find people really showing terrible behavior in terms of undermining others, trying to show that they are the best. And so what's important at this time is that you need to understand what are the character flaws that somehow become more prominent when you're under stress and that might even become a liability in the workplace. And so it's important to be clear on these. Remember, I think this week when you were talking about, the week where you're talking about emotional awareness, to me this is about self-awareness and managing self. Because if you're in a workplace where there might be job cuts, if you're in a workplace where they're thinking, who do we skill and who not, you need to be at your best. But if you're not careful, the anxiety and the pressure, the leak in your boat is what will show you up not at your best. You won't be professional. So that's what I call plug the leaks in your boat. Right. These are the parts of you that could bring you down.
This is the Effective Living Series. We're talking to Chaka Awori in our third week. We're looking at the world of work and leading self. She's told us the not so good news, but the good news is you can do something about some of this. So ground yourself, get connected, and do other things. So she's just given us 2 points under grounding yourself. What else do we need to do to ground ourselves?
Invest in your health and well-being.
All right.
And as part of this Effective Living Series, I think you've talked quite a bit about that. And I actually like the way you emphasize that in your first week.
Yeah.
Because indeed, you find that because we're all going to be under a lot of stress and anxiety, this is where it starts to show up in your body and your mental health. And yet this is not the time that you want to have a crisis, an emotional, mental, or physical health crisis. Huh? So it's important now to be proactive. Take the advice you learned in the first 2 weeks of the Effective Living Series and put it into action. Huh?
Okay.
The other tips is having a growth mindset. Your mindset is going to be very key in terms of how you ground yourself.
Mm-hmm.
And the last one I would say in terms of how you ground yourself, because this is about resilience, is about diversifying your income. And I know again in the series you'll be talking about your finances, because we're finding that resilience during this world of work will come from understanding that your income cannot come just from one place.
At all.
Yeah. So that those are some of the tips around grounding yourself, becoming resilient.
So the onus is on the individual.
It's not only an individual, but in this case, we're saying, how can you be proactive yourself to make sure that you're grounded when the storms come, as they will and as they have?
Great. Let's talk about getting connected.
So now, getting connected, this is the second principle, and now this is about, now you're grounded.
Mm-hmm.
It's about how do we seize opportunities in this new world of work. Huh?
Mm-hmm.
The key message here is that this is not the time to stay in your corner with the friends and family you've known since, I don't know what, kindergarten. Huh? Opportunities come to those with a wide range of quality relationships or community. Let me say that again. Opportunities come to those with a wide range of quality relationships or community. So how do you get connected to develop these kinds of relationships? One is definitely about making time and investing in a wide range of relationships. Huh? So it's getting out. Huh? It's about the alumni networks, associations, Rotary. Huh? The second is about strengthening the quality of relationships you have. Huh?
So not just the amount.
No, it's not just the amount. It's actually the quality. Eh? I find it's about being in touch with people before you need something from them. Too many people, they're like, hey, you're calling me. What is it you want? So how do you check in? Call someone when you don't want anything.
That's true.
How do you help someone constantly, or even before they're asked, you realize somebody's in a need. You introduce them to somebody. You connect them to someone. So I often say, manage your social capital, or rather, let's say, don't manage your social capital the way we've managed our economy. Meaning, don't go into debt.
where
people owe you, you owe people so much. Rather, make sure you're always in the red.
Give more
than you're constantly asking
for.
That's what we mean in terms of managing the quality.
No man, nothing.
Well, it's okay to owe, but make sure that you've given a lot so that by the time I come to you...
So more people owe you.
Thank you.
Than
more
you owe.
People owe you. That's exactly
That's
exactly it. Be helpful. Be generous.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
The last one about being connected is being visible.
All right.
This is the time to be visible. And it can happen in different ways. Huh?
Mm.
If you work in a big organization, visibility is about raising your hand to volunteer for opportunities where you're visible to those who matter. It might be doing extra work, doing things outside of your JD, volunteering for this committee, but at least it means, you know why this matters? It means when decisions are made, they're like, I remember Bernard. He had a chance to show us that he's really good at this and this and this. Let's put him on that. Huh? Now, if you're not in a big organization, another way you get visibility, naturally, is social media. And I think too many of us are not leveraging social media in the right way. Eh?
Okay.
And often I say something like LinkedIn is a really good platform professionally, since we're talking about professionally. Eh? And a way you can do this, make sure your profile, I always tell people, make sure your profile in LinkedIn is up to date. Make sure it's capturing your strengths. And if you want to be known for a particular thing, write more about it. You'll start to find that if you're writing about a particular thing, the algorithms will start to connect you with people and that you're growing your network.
Okay. So that's the second point. The connections must be rooted. And I like the analogy. Let's talk about being future ready then.
So being future ready, this is the last principle. How do you do this very practically? First is understand the trends in your sector. So if you're engineering, if you're in banking, if you're in the media, understand what is happening in your sector because you're regularly reading. So for instance, I would be regularly reading Harvard Business Review, McKinsey, because I want to know what's the world of work in leadership and in the world of work generally. So that's understand the trends in your sector, what's happening in the future. When you're clear about that, then you can invest in reskilling or upskilling to remain relevant. And let me distinguish the two. Upskilling is where you're getting additional skills in your current role.
Okay.
So for instance, in my role, leadership development, coaching, I realized in 2020 to upskill, I needed to increase my digital skills. I needed to get really good at training online. So on Zoom, on Teams, that's an example of upskilling. And often it's about digital skills.
Okay.
Reskilling is where you're like, I've studied the trends, not much happening here. Maybe I need to start thinking about a whole nother line of work. And so then I start acquiring additional training or opportunities to learn about that. So that's to be future ready, you might have to do that investment. And unfortunately, people need to recognize but they may have to pay for it themselves because companies, the way I see things going, may not have as many resources to do that. And again, for many people, the resources they put aside for this investment itself may be locked up or saved. So sometimes you have to get creative. Right? You might not have lots of money around to do that, but there are lots of free resources online. Eh? Next one about being future ready is continue to invest in soft skills.
Okay.
Yeah? These are still critical, and I know Michael will be talking a lot more about what are the skills ready.
Yeah.
Another one, Bernard, is the new world of work means you have to throw out the idea of a linear career path.
All right.
Too many of us think, okay, I'll start here, then I'll move here. But no, increasingly, what it looks like in terms of our professional journeys, it's more of a zigzag. And what they're saying is 50%, this is a statistics I read recently, 56% of candidates report applying for jobs outside their current area of expertise. So over half of people were applying for jobs that they had never done before, but maybe they had studied, they went and upskilled or reskilled essentially to be able to do that. Yeah. So throw out the idea of a linear path. And the last one is really in terms of being future ready, go beyond thinking of employment opportunities to work opportunities. And then what do I mean by this? Many people are finding that having one job is either too insecure or doesn't pay you enough to live. So instead, they have different work streams. So maybe I might be on a platform like Fiverr, where I offer my services as a graphic designer.
All right.
On the other side, I may also have another side gig where I'm doing some jewelry thing, and I put that on Instagram. On another side, I might do a little consulting where I'm doing giving people advice or coaching. So that's what we call the diverse work opportunities. So that's a mindset shift, that to be future ready, start thinking not necessarily of this one job, but these different work opportunities.
This is still Effective Living Series 2023 on the theme Our Year Starter Pack. Week 3, we're focused on professional priorities. My guest is Taka Wori, who's with the Busara Group. Very beautiful file she gave me, Busara Africa. Leading self, leading others with wisdom. So actually, your tagline?
Yes, yes.
It goes right into the topic.
Yes.
Leading self, leading others with wisdom.
Yes.
And I like the African, is it an African design?
The Adinkra symbol. Now I'll test you. Which Adinkra symbol is that?
I have no idea. I'm not good at it.
It's something about knowledge. Huh? When you know, you will know.
What is it in Chi? Is it something Dia? Nansapo or something? Yeah, I'm supposed something. Anyway, so we've been told three very important things. Get grounded, get connected, and then be future ready. So let's conclude with a few more things to do, some practical ideas and how to tie everything up. What do we do next? Yes. And of course, if people want to contact you. So I understand getting grounded, take roots downwards first, and then get connected. And I actually think it's an order. You get grounded first before you don't start by connecting. So people just go on networking things and there's nothing. So you get grounded first.
Yes.
You've got a tree takes root downwards first before it spreads out.
Yes.
And then now that you're connected, you are future ready.
Yes.
So this turbulence, how long should we expect it? And what are your thoughts in conclusion? Because these are very difficult times, at least financially and economically and socially for a lot of people.
Yes, they are.
Yeah.
It's interesting, Bernard, when I looked back at the last times I've been with you on the Effective Living series, the conversation has been about resilience and turbulent times. And here we are again. So I think what this is telling us is that we are now living in times where we should expect the unexpected.
Okay.
So let's not think of an end to this. Sure. Let's imagine that none of us could have imagined COVID. None of us could ever imagined that our economy could get to this level.
My Lord.
We couldn't have imagined it. Huh? So let's expect the unprecedented. Huh? Let's prepare ourselves. And I always say that therefore, if we expect the unexpected, there are two things you can do. One is indeed to strengthen your resilience. That's going to continue to be a thing that's grounding yourself. The second is about preparing yourself to seize opportunities. Always in crises. Sorry to say, but there are always opportunities. So that's how you seize the day.
Okay. So in terms of practical, what do I do next? I just listened to this. I'm inspired. I want to get going. What should I do? Write a list, give Busara Africa a call?
Yeah, so...
what do I do?
So a couple of things. If you are indeed ready to move from just listening and talking to action, if you're ready to get support in terms of concrete tools, courses, support network, and if you want to be part of a community of others who are navigating this space and trying to learn from each other, then join our recently launched Africa Leaders Circle. Africa Leaders Circle.
Okay.
It's an e-learning community that brings leaders across the continent together to learn and share how to navigate this new world of work. Mm-hmm. But we also do that through courses, tools, and discussion forums. Mm-hmm. So visit our website, busara-africa.com, to learn more.
Yeah. I mean, the focus of the show has been on the individual, but for companies, will these apply? Because I feel in your preamble, the assumption is a lot of companies will try to make profit and therefore they'll do many things that may not necessarily inure to the benefit of the individual, which is why you're saying get grounded, get connected. But if a company wants to survive these times, and this is a bonus question, how should they be thinking about organizing themselves? Because I know that they'll say, well, you also need to cut your costs, you need to, but is that really the way to go? Because I feel if you're more people-centric, if you are more, if you make yourself an employer that people want to work with, give people food to eat and things, sort of people, high-quality people may want to come to you, give flexible working hours. So when you are discussing this from a company perspective, how should we think about a company also wanting to do well in these times?
It's interesting. The three principles actually apply to a company.
Okay.
When you think about it, I would say first, get grounded. When you're going through resilience, when you're going through turbulence as a company, what grounds you? And often I will say, what grounds you in a company during turbulence is your culture, where you have a culture of caring, because who's your core? It's your employees, unless you're selling widgets. Often it's the human beings that make up the company.
Yeah.
So where you have a culture of caring for people, taking care of their well-being, being empathetic, and we've talked about the kind of leadership you need during crisis, showing empathy, that, and even if you can't, because what tends to happen is when you do that and you're grounded in that type of a culture, even though you may not be able to pay salaries for a period of time, people will understand that it's not just about you and making yourself and profits, but it's saying that if we're trying to stay in the market, yes, we have a mission, but we put our people first. So grounding yourself in your people and your culture becomes a powerful way of stable. Otherwise, everybody will jump ship because they're like, the culture here is every man or every woman for themselves.
Each man for himself, God for us all.
Yeah, exactly. So I would say that's the first thing in terms of getting grounded. Getting connected is the same thing, because as a company, we talked about this when COVID came. We said one of the things a company does to become resilient is you cannot work on your own. You're starting to say, what are the types of partnerships I need? What are the types of alliances, consortia I need to be in to seize opportunities in the market? What are the relationships, maybe with service providers, maybe my finance? All of those relationships help you as a company to navigate difficult times. Being future ready, again, you can see for a company, it's saying, all right, where is this market going to? How may I have to adjust my business model to remain relevant, to continue to be useful and helpful to my customers or my clients? So interestingly enough, they also apply.
I think this is amazing. So even though this topic was more for the individual employee or person working, they do apply to companies as well.
Yes.
Because I feel a lot of companies are struggling and they have no idea how to manage themselves.
Yes.
All right. So in terms of Busara itself, where can we find you? Did you give us your website? Did
yes.
you give
us so your... it's busara-africa.com. But connect with me on social media. If you just even Google my name, Taka Awori.
T-A-A-K-A.
Yes.
Awori. Do you respond to your... messages.
So yes. If you connect with me on LinkedIn, I will definitely respond to that. Do connect with me. You can connect with me on LinkedIn. If you Google my name, our website will come up. Get on Facebook. We are also on Facebook as well.
Just finally, you've been in people development and corporate, like you help companies. How rewarding is it when you, I mean, how do you know you are doing well? Because you've been, like, I know people have come to you. Some people have come through this program to you that you've been talking to. How do you measure? Because it's not like you are mining gold and you have 20,000 metric tons that you can sell, all right? So how does Bursera Africa know that they are making impact? How do they know that they are doing well beyond the bottom line?
So there's two ways, huh? Mm-hmm. Because we work both with individual leaders and we work with organizations, particularly around organizational culture, team building. At the individual level, particularly when I do coaching and leadership development, people will definitely be able to tell you, oh my goodness, Taka, what an impact. But also for a lot of the work that we do, we have measures to for companies to do their return on investment. So for instance, how were people behaving before? And what was the leadership practice afterwards? But it's often the testimonials at the individual level where people will say, wow. And we've worked, I've been doing this now, Bernard, can you imagine, almost 10 years.
In Ghana?
Yes, in Ghana. And so people will tell, one of our program associate now, Robert, is somebody who I trained 9 years ago. So he says, I benefited from the leadership. Then he was, he's gone on to be country director, Amnesty. Yeah. So those kinds of impacts, those testimonials are powerful. At a company level, what we tend to find is we have return clients. So companies we've worked with 1 year, they work on key issues, then they come back and say, okay, this has shifted. And a lot of our global clients are that way. They'll come back on one issue and say, we're working on this, because often we find that organizational culture, changing business models, these are not one-time things. These are things that you're constantly working on over a period of time. So
I have a couple more questions for you. When I talk to companies, maybe they are inviting me to talk about something, they will say one of their biggest challenges is that when they invest in people, people don't stay. So almost every company I go to and we talk about is, how do you keep your people? So like, we've identified this young person, paid for them to learn the skill, they become so good, so it's a programmer, and then they get poached and they get worried and they wonder whether the solution is to not invest in people or to invest in so many people, and then even if some people leave. Okay, that's the first question. The second question is, I speak to people who are much younger than myself, they see the workplace differently. So I was born in the 80s, and for us, I may be generalizing, but we sort of be very loyal. Yes. When I speak to the younger people, they feel, you know what, I want to do my own thing. I want to do gigs. So like, I can come and do 3 hours for you and do my own thing. And I feel they're more confident that way. And I'm not sure whether it's just a sign of their generation, the way the opportunities, or whether the companies are doing something wrong.
No, in fact, let me start with the latter. What you're seeing is a reflection of the changing world of work. So what the younger people are recognizing is that you can get a much more rewarding professional experience and better financial income where you're doing different gigs. You're doing different things. You're not stuck in one particular role. So it's not that as companies we're doing anything wrong. What's incumbent upon us is to be flexible enough to say, if these are the services we need, if this is the talent we need, how do I structure our systems
so that we can benefit from the person and let them also
do other things?
I get it.
What are our accountability mechanisms? How do I hold them accountable? How do I pay them? All of those things. So it's us. It's about us.
It's our job to make sure they can give of their best, but still be fulfilled.
That's exactly it. Which turns to the retention issue. If we're assuming retention is only about keeping people for 5-10 years, then we're losing the plot. It's about, while they're there, being as fulfilled as possible and creating a learning organization so that if you do have a lot of people coming in, it's quick to learn and pick up.
I like that.
And if you also have a culture where it's easy to attract. The more you have a culture where it's easy to attract, they're probably also going to stay longer.
That's probably the entry into a different book. You launched a book recently, though.
Just yes.
What's the title? When can we get the book?
Okay, so it's Leadership in Africa Redefined.
Yes.
Okay, and you can find it at Shell Signboard,
okay.
Video Bookshops.
Okay.
And yeah, those are the, and of course on Amazon online.
Wonderful. Yes. Taka, it's always a pleasure having you.
Ah, likewise, Bernard.
Taka is with Busa Africa. She's talking to us about leading self in the new world of work, but we touched on many things. If you like the video, click and share. Thank you for watching. We'll be back next time with another program. See you next time. Bye bye.
It's your life, got to get it right. Take your time, take this sex.
Effective Living series, leading self in the new world of work, providing very powerful anchors for you in the challenging environment of the world of work. Effective Living series is on every morning at 9 a.m. on the radio and at 9:30 on TV. I'm still here with Nathan, and we'll be back with a short conversation.
Take your time.
Okay, Nathan, I've been hearing you talk about Ugo Flip.
Yeah.
Or Ugo Flip.
Yeah.
You know, and the Ugo Flip thing, you know, I'm sure I can watch it, you know.
Don't worry, we've brought in somebody
Richmond Achampong Daku, business manager for Ugo Flip. I've been hearing you talk about Ugo Flip.
Yes, Ugo.
And which one is flipping?
So, you know, I'm sure he'll give us more details. But essentially, it's a great way, or simpler way, let me put it that way, for people to win a house.
Get on the property ladder.
Yeah, get on the property ladder and all of that. Great way, just play a game.
So real estate gaming brought together.
Yes.
Great. In a very interesting alliance. Richmond, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Bernard.
I've seen you on Breakfast Daily. I think you were on, was it Thursday or Friday?
Friday
with, was it Framer?
Yes.
And you were talking about the Ugo Flip thing. So what is this concept of Ugo Flip?
Okay, good morning once again to your listeners worldwide. Ugo Flip is a real estate game platform, basically where games are published, tickets are bought, and various prizes are won.
Okay.
Bernard, we have been in the property industry for well over 20 years. And when I talk about we, I'm talking about our real estate affiliate, which is Emerald Properties.
You have a real estate affiliate.
Correct. Okay. We already have a real estate affiliate. They've been building homes for the past about 20 years. And we have realized that, Bernard, I mean, a house or a home is one of as Maslow, Abraham Maslow would say, one of the basic needs.
Yes.
You don't have a place to live, you are in huge trouble.
Mm.
So we decide that there is a huge housing gap or housing deficit in Ghana, in our part of the world.
Mm-hmm.
So we sat down and we were like, what can we do to help address this problem?
Okay.
So we decided to bring a fun way and an affordable way to address this problem.
Okay.
So that's how come YugoFlip came as a real estate game platform where we are going to publish games and winners will win houses and other prizes.
I see.
But when I talk about affordable way, what I mean is that anyone taking to buy from us in with the aim of winning a prize, that one ticket give you a loyalty point.
Okay.
And each loyalty point is worth $3.
Is it?
Every loyalty point that you gain from YugoFlip is worth $3.
Mm-hmm.
What we are saying is that when you accumulate these loyalty points over some time, when you approach us that, listen, I want to purchase a house from your real estate affiliate, that accumulation you've done, that amount you've gained, is used to reduce the price of the house for you.
Okay.
So invariably, when you purchase any one ticket, you are saving $3.
So you are killing three birds with one stone.
Correct.
Who is eligible to play?
Bernard, anyone, because we are regulated by the Game Commission, their laws say that until you are 18 years and above, you can't participate in any game of chance. So because of that, if you are 18 years and above, you are eligible to be part of the YugoFlip game.
Do you have to be a Ghanaian?
You may not have to be a Ghanaian because the system is such that wherever you are in the world, you can register, you can purchase a ticket. Just that, as we speak, you can't purchase a ticket with a wallet that is outside Ghana.
So it has to be here?
Correct.
The money must be here?
Correct.
All right. Now, before we talk about the games currently published, what's the website?
The website is www.yugoflip.com.
Where YugoFlip is spelled?
U-G-O-F-L-I-P.
Oh, Ugo. Yugo. It's like Nigerian name. Ugo.
Ugo. Yeah. Somebody told me
so
that.
So it's not Y-O-U-G-O.
No.
It's U-G-O.
U-G-O.
YugoFlip.
YugoFlip. Somebody told me that you listen to City and some people are saying Ugo, others are saying Ugo, and I'm saying that once you know that it's U-G-O,
that's all. Okay. Whether it's Ugo or U-G-O. So you're talking about various games that you can play. Throw more light on that.
Okay. So currently, as I speak to you right now, we've already spelled the website, and I must say that it is not an app.
Okay.
You not find it on the Play Store, you not find it on the App Store or wherever. You just have to go straight to the website. That is www.yugoflip.com. When you go there, you will see two games as we speak. One game is called Win Big Bronze. And another one is called Cash and Save.
Okay.
I'm going to throw light on both quickly.
The
Win Big Bronze is a game that is giving a two-bedroom house out.
Win
Big Bronze. Yes. Win Big Bronze. When you go there, you see a house there. And you see the picture of a house there. Actually, that house is in Pram Pram now. It's a two-bedroom, fully finished house that we are giving out.
Hey.
We are selling 25,000 tickets for that anyway. Mm-hmm. Each ticket is 25 Ghana cedis.
And Nathan, Pram Pram is where your mother is from.
Yes.
You killed three birds with one stone.
Yes.
Get a house there.
So one ticket is 25 Ghana cedis. And you are selling 25,000 tickets. With this particular game, the condition is that for the winner to be eligible to receive the house, all 25,000 tickets must be finished. So if all 25,000 tickets are finished and a winner is generated, that winner will ask the person, do you actually want the house or you want to take money? Because Bernard, we are this game is open to people. It's an either or situation anyway. So people, somebody may be in Tamale, somebody may be in Borga, Sunyai, or even in Accra, may not want a house in Pram Pram. Somebody too may want a house in Pram Pram. So if all the tickets run out, that's 100%, we ask you, do you actually want the house or you want to take money? If you say you want money, we'll give you the cash equivalent of it.
Okay.
If you want the house, we initiate the transfer of ownership
straight
to your name. Yes. Yes. Wow. So that is one of the games.
So that's the Win Big Bronze.
Correct.
Then the other one is what?
The other one is called Cash and Save.
Cash and Save.
Cash and Save. And as the name connotes, it is a game that we are running for. We are running every month. Every month, we choose a winner. That one, irrespective of the number of tickets that have been sold at the close of the month, a winner is generated and that person takes home 20,000 cedis cash.
Just like that?
Just like that. Some of you say just like that.
Cash and save.
So it is called cash and save because whilst you are buying the tickets to win this cash of 20,000, mm-hmm. every one ticket you buy goes into your savings. Mm-hmm. That loyalty points that I told you you gain anytime you purchase a ticket. Mm-hmm. Whilst you are winning, you are hoping to win the cash. Mm-hmm. At the same time, every one ticket you buy is giving you a loyalty point that gives you savings. That is how can we call it cash and save. So as I speak to you, those two games are there now that people are buying tickets for, and I'm urging people to buy tickets for them.
We're speaking to the business manager for YugoFlip, Richmond Achampong Daku. YugoFlip is a very interesting business, a real estate gaming company where players win houses, land, and cash prizes. And they have two main games. I'm sure there are more that will come up. The Win Big Bronze and the Cash and Save, where different combinations of things can be done to win different combinations of things. Essentially, you buy a ticket, you flip, and it saves you a loyalty point towards the purchase of a home from their partners, Emerald Properties. Or you also save to either get cash or you get other properties. So let's talk about the loyalty points and how people can get in touch with you. So when you talk about loyalty points, can you throw a bit more light on that?
Okay, so like I initially said, the loyalty point is gained anytime you purchase a ticket. Mm-hmm. So when you purchase one ticket, you have one loyalty point. Mm-hmm. When you purchase 10 tickets, you have 10 loyalty points. Mm-hmm. So the more you purchase the tickets mm-hmm. and accumulate the points, it will get to a time that maybe, for example, maybe in the space of 3 years, mm. you have accumulated like, you have bought like 1,000 tickets. Mm-hmm. Because you bought 1,000 tickets, mm-hmm. you would have 1,000 loyalty points mm-hmm. extending to $3,000 because mm-hmm. each point is $3. Yes, okay. Each point is $3. Yeah. Yes. Mm-hmm. So when you have that amount, when you approach us that, listen, I want to purchase a house now, I'm not ready. You are going to point the house that you want to purchase anyway. Mm-hmm. When you point it out, you look at the price, then deduct that amount of points that you have accumulated from the price, then the rest you take your mortgage or whatever way that you want to pay and address it. Mm. But before I go to how you can contact us, another game is coming on, I think today or tomorrow. It's called Land and Save. Land and Save. It's just like the Win Big Bronze. That one, a land will be put up, is the same as at the same place, Soli Lagoon Estate in Pram Pram. It's a land, it's a bare land. Somebody may want a land to build him or herself. So that one too, it will come out today. The ticket is 25 cedis. You buy and you can actually win. So if you want to contact us, we are on www.yugoflip.com, like I said. Mm-hmm. When you go there, you can purchase your ticket. If you want to call, WhatsApp, Telegram us, we are on 055-133-9879. You can also drop us an email on info@yugoflip.com. Mm. info@yugoflip.com, and we respond to you.
Wonderful. Thank you very much, Richmond, business manager for YugoFlip, talking to us about their games and how to get in touch. Thank you so much.
This is the City Breakfast Show, the city's biggest conversation.
Join the conversation on the City Breakfast Show on Facebook at facebook.com/city97.3, Twitter at twitter.com/city973, and Instagram at instagram.com/city973 with the hashtag CityCBS.
Man, I've just been busy these last few weeks. My company has asked me to attend this conference in Canada, scheduled for December of 2022. I submitted my application in March, but I've still not heard back from the immigration office. I don't know where to start. Time is ticking. If only there was someone to check in on my business visa status.
the man who's been sitting in the show, Charlie Nathan. You're a big man. I want to wish two people happy birthday. This is coming from a couple of friends of ours. Abena Oseya Sari is the Deputy Minister for Finance. Abena was my senior at Legon. She was in the economics class. She's actually mates with John Kuma.
I see.
Can you imagine? She's the Deputy Minister of Finance. So whoever
both Deputy Finance.
Yeah, right. Whoever taught them obviously did something right. So Abena Oseya Sari, happy birthday to you. Mm-hmm. And this is coming from myself, Konkojo Akoto, and a few other people. And then Dr. Elvis Ohiming Mensah. Mm-hmm. Now, he's a senior resident orthopedics department mm-hmm. at Kolebu. Charlie,
mm-hmm.
I entered the Kolebu system over the Christmas period.
You're not happy?
No, they did their best. And in the circumstance, they are working very hard. Charlie, they did some joinings and things. They try.
Okay.
So, Dr. Elvis is a Liverpool fan too.
Oh!
Correct bone doctor.
The things have been.
He's rather screwed on. Just like he'd rather not watch the team these days.
Well, you push to try. We watched United for God knows how many years. And then let me say a blessing.
No, it's not that. Hey, please, it's not that level of decline, please.
This one is coming
this
from...
This is a cyclical slump.
This one coming from my good friend, Jillian Akuno, from the enforcement unit of the Ghana Immigration. He says this to his son, Jason Israel Akuno.
All right.
Of St. Adelaide International School. He turned 9 on Saturday. He says, thank God for your life from your mom, your dad, and your siblings. And then Pastor Fred also sends
Fred
Yemo McDavis.
MacArthur Davis.
Hey!
Fred Niyemo.
He has another name, Steph, I forget.
Something there.
Yeah, plenty of names.
He says this one, happy birthday to Fred Peace Niyemo. Dola of Tema Community 7.
Fred is a proper Tema boy.
Eh,
oh,
I
yeah.
didn't know.
Oh, he's a Tema man. Lots of comments coming in. The City Prime News at midday will give you the latest on the debt exchange program with highlights of our interview with Chairman Sabunsu. Watch out for Eyewitness News because I'm sure by the time Umar Rusanda comes on, there would have been a big announcement on another aspect of the exchange program. City News at 10 is next, and then AJ Akwaku Sapong, who's the mistress of the mid-morning. I call it the mid-morning mistress. She takes over. As they say, she's large and in charge. Thank you for listening. Big thank you to Nathan Kwao, holding the fort in a difficult time for me. Nathan, you're a big man.
Thank you. Thank
you. May you be rewarded in more ways than
Amen.
than Amen. You know.
Amen.
Yeah.
It was a time of learning,
yes,
growth, and evolution.
You have become bigger. As I said, bigger every day.
And the biggest takeaway,
yes,
for me and for everybody who's listening,
yes,
work hard as though it's unto the Lord. You
Amen
never know who's watching.
Amen. Oh, amen. Oh, Charlie, they turn the scripture if you
Amen.
Caleb Kuda is also here.
Good morning, man.
He's also working for the Lord. So the news at 10. What are they saying?
Bernard, coming up, government's deadline to bondholders to sign on to the domestic debt exchange program expires today.